Wow, that's a magical vignette we have there. I don't know if I was supposed to play that tonight. I just came in to the studio and that was sitting on our files, so I just felt compelled to share that with you. Promoting it a little bit early, naturally, November 21st. We got a little bit of time before that arrives, but yes, your eyes don't deceive you. We've been teasing it across multiple shows. Somehow, some way, we've dedicated ourselves to doing a Twitch marathon watch along in November where we watch all five films consecutively, no breaks in one night. That's of course 10 and a half hours of hot vampire and werewolf action, and got a lot of surprises lined up for that. I think we're gonna try to raise some money for somebody. We don't even know who yet. You know, there's any number of worthy causes emerging this year, and sadly to say, who knows what else will emerge before November. So we get a little out of ourselves with that. That's something to look forward to. We're going to make a real interesting time out of that. But we don't need to worry about Twilight right now. We've got plenty to talk about tonight on this episode. How you guys doing out there? Hope you're safe. Hope you're happy. Hope you're healthy. Thanks for joining us this week. I'm really excited for this episode. It's our monthly book club episode. Some of my favorite discussion comes out of our book club episodes. And tonight we're going to be talking about Survivor Song by Paul Tremblay, one of my favorite contemporary horror authors. So I'm really excited to cover one of his books. We're going to be talking about Lovecraft Country. Didn't really get to it last week, at least the show that is. We had, of course, the magnificent Alok Mishra and Naomi Grossman on. And when the conversation is flying like that, when Alok takes the wheel, you just let him sail that ship whatever direction he wants. And we just didn't find Lovecraft Country on the way. So we're going to talk about the show a little bit today. And then we got a bunch of horror movie news and trailers as well. So tons to discuss, but you had to know I couldn't do it by myself. And I got to bring him in. Number one, the top goblin himself. Here he is, Connor Breedlove.
How's it going?
I'm magnificent. How are you doing, my friend?
I could be better. I have a decrepit back of a 50-year-old, so.
Feeling a little brittle tonight.
Yeah, yeah. All I did was walk up a flight of stairs, and that did it for me. So I'm doing okay. I'm trying to mask the pain with G Fuel.
I feel like if you just coat your brittle spine and all those vitamins and minerals.
Yes, and lead. You can find a variety of flavors at select Sheets in Ohio. So if you're in Ohio, Sheets, you can find a variety of flavors. Go buy yourself some G Fuel.
I love your strategy of mentioning that it has lead content, but then also letting people know where they could buy it locally, just so we still maybe shake out that sponsorship one day.
It's trace amounts of lead. I mean, do with that information.
Content. It always comes up every single time we talk about G Fuel on this show. In spite of that, you are drinking it valiantly, maybe almost obsessively. You were going on special trips just to get some.
Yeah, I might have drove like 25 minutes to a Sheets to get it.
And what flavor do we have tonight?
I chugged some sour chug rug.
The chug rug. What does that taste like?
A sour blue raspberry, I guess. And now I'm on to a rainbow sherbet, which tastes exactly like melted sherbet.
So wow, two in a night.
Yeah,
two in a night. You're
more in the fridge. You want to test it out. You hit the four.
We're probably going to need a couple of those November 21st. I got a feeling if we're going to stay away.
Oh, yeah. I'll buy a couple tubs of the powder. I'll be fine.
Couple tubs. Well, I think your spine's going to be doing just fine before the end of the night, friend. You're going to be just skipping up the stairs. You're going to just be somersaulting up there with your reinforced lead spine.
I hope so. Like a pseudo Wolverine.
Lead skeleton. And you can hear her cracking open a colon with the boys on the side. Her name's not on the screen, but she's here, very much here. Go ahead, go lean in a little bit, lean a little bit. I got my favorite goal on screen for the first time in a long time. I don't think since, I got a little, I was in the splash zone on that. I don't think you've been on since our last book club.
Yeah, episode. I needed a break.
Needed a break.
That was a really intense episode.
Did you
do you mind if I ask what you guys are enjoying beverage wise?
So
open mine real quick.
So I was just handed this. I don't even 100% know what it is yet.
It's delicious.
Sun, Earth, and Central Waters Brewing Company Mud Puppy Porter. It's got a little mud puppy. It's a favorite among dark beer lovers.
Brewed and canned in Amherst, Wisconsin.
It's going. We're going in for a sip.
Mm. Nice and smooth.
Pretty good.
Pretty good.
Speaking of pretty good, we've got a couple other frames to bring into this. And I'm very excited to welcome them in. You saw them. We mentioned the last book club episode where we talked about Lovecraft Country, the novel. You met him then, but he ain't gone. We're bringing him back in. Welcome him back to the show. The very sassy and controversial Adam Wassel.
Hi. feeling sassy.
Would you agree? I mean, I feel like last time you were here, you were kicking up all sorts of... Were you the one who said, like, fuck Nemo or whatever?
No, I saw Nemo. I believe that was Connor Breed's Descent that did that.
That's true. That's right.
Hence the break.
That's right.
Yeah. No, I just bring the worst out in people, but I don't think I'm bad.
You don't think you're bad.
I think you're great, Adam.
Thanks. Likewise, except for the kombucha. That's gross.
No kombucha tonight.
Well, I'm not
tonight.
Drinking it anymore, probably ever again.
No kombucha tonight. She did purchase me a jalapeno kombucha shortly after that episode. So,
yikes.
You can get real nasty.
What was your opinion of that?
I drank it all. I like a little spice. I like a little booch.
It was like jalapeno kiwi cucumber.
No.
A little spicy booch.
Yeah, I like spicy, but not in liquid form.
A little spicy SCOBY.
Like a spicy ice cream. Like, I'm for it. Spicy, like the chili chocolate, stuff like that. Yeah, I'm all for it. But spicy booch, I'm going to leave that on the road where they probably found it in the first place.
That sounds so disgusting.
Sip some hot
spicy
germs.
Spicy booch.
Speaking of spicy booch, welcome to the show for the first time. And I'm very excited about this as well. My great friend, a true spooky dude. The wonderful Sam Hayest.
What an intro. I don't know if I can live up to that. This is pretty high stakes there, my friend.
Spiciest.
I, for the record, would also like to state that I am staunchly anti-booch.
Anti-booch
here.
Even the picante booch?
Definitely anti-picante booch. Not happening.
Not even just like a mild booch?
Maybe, if you catch me in the right mood.
Okay.
Next time I see you.
And a booch mood. We'll see. We'll find out. Guys, welcome aboard. Welcome to Reely Scared.
Thank you.
Welcome. As you can see, we could navigate any variety of topics on this show. It is horror movie oriented, I would say. But you never know what kind of tangent we'll travel down. But thank you for joining us tonight, guys. And thank you to everybody at home that's tuning in tonight. People at home know you're hurting, Connor. They can just
tell I have a nice pillow on my back, so I have a decent posture to keep slouching to a minimum so I don't further pull my back.
What about an ice pack? You need an ice pack, friend?
Or a heating pad, yeah.
No, I may just mix this G Fuel with some vodka.
And then apply directly to the forehead.
Perfect. I think that's just Four Loko. is what you'll have made. Maybe you should just slide a can of G Fuel up your shirt and like sit on it. A cold one.
Oh, I might do it.
Sitting on
two G Fuels to my back.
Yeah, Epsom salt bath.
Like a jet pack.
Epsom salts are the move.
Well,
just mix them with the G Fuel though. Like G Fuel, Epsom salts,
one,
in a
one for
tub.
One.
The
operate non, in, you're good to
the,
go.
Yeah, the non-chug rug. Don't drink that. You'll barf. Promise. It's what they're good for. Epsom salts.
I'm pretty upset. My body language is so like apparent.
Yeah, the chat's calling you out.
Oh God,
Jose's got you. He knows. He knows you're hurting. I've not noticed
for the
myself.
For the sake of the back.
Well, I hope you can make it through to the end, my friend. I hope you can do it. We'll try our best not to make this a 3-hour one. We'll try not to hit that Alok Mishra runtime. But didn't have that much luck last week. And last book club we have, pretty long, pretty extensive.
We did go over 3 hours, yeah.
We got there. That's,
or
that's
we went happening. To yeah, we went to midnight, didn't we?
Yeah, I think we did, yeah. That's not the plan tonight. We'll see.
Yeah, I think the last, like, three episodes of this whole entire, like, channel have been 3 hours long.
Hmm.
Yep. Not you, trying to make that in every
hour week. Really scared, and then a 3 hour real talk. So it's been long.
We're gonna try to hit like a cool two, right? That sounds like a good idea. We'll see if we can do it.
I'm down.
A cool two.
We can make that happen.
A cool two, and we'll hit a hot 10.5 in a few months.
real quick, I just want to shout out Jose. He has a really good band, La Verte. If you're into ambient music, they have a new album coming out soon. So when that drops, definitely check it out.
Right on. Jose, if you want to throw a link in the chat, share the wealth. Let us hear see what you can do. Let's start this show off, however, how we always do. We got to go around the table and just find out what we've been watching lately. Who's first? Who should I pick? I went first last time. I think maybe
Sam's brand new to the show.
Well, he has to see how it's done. I don't want to put him on the spot.
Come on, Jessica, don't throw me to the wolves like that.
Okay, I'll go first.
Oh, okay, my favorite.
Perfect.
Sorry, Sam.
I'll tilt it ever so slightly while she paints next to me.
Sorry, I'm painting at the same time. Let me just...
Did you figure out what color you were going to paint that mystery square?
I did, but then I figured out I painted the wrong fucking color.
Wait, are you also doing a arts type thing in the background?
What?
Are you doing a painting?
Oh, yeah.
A paint-by-number kind of a thing?
Yep.
Olivia is doing embroidery in the background.
Oh, so, that? Those are just wall, like, stickers? Like, wall art? It's nothing I'm doing.
I just think it's ironic that our significant others are both doing art in the background.
Oh, yeah. Nice.
Olivia is doing embroidery. That's her latest project.
Well, anything that keeps the mind busy is good for things like anxiety. So that's why I'm doing it. And we could all keep our minds busy during this whole pandemic thing, to be completely honest.
Agreed.
I dropped pictures.
So today we watched the Disney sing-along on Disney Plus, Volume 1 and Volume 2.
Cheers.
We watched Peanut Butter Falcon today.
Yeah, well, I drank a peanut. Is this peanut butter stout?
No, it's not a peanut butter stout, man.
You would think I would know be drinking it. But we watched peanut butter stout.
Did you cry? I cried.
I didn't cry, but I found it a purely delightful experience.
There was a lot of moments where like, oh my gosh. But I did not cry.
No, I didn't cry. But I'm very happy to finally have seen it because it's been on the watch list forever.
Yeah.
And I only heard great things, and it really was just joyous.
It really was.
Sam or Adam, have you heard of or seen the Peanut Butter Falcon?
I have not. That is one that is on my watch list, which I think
It's not on my watch list, but I've heard of it.
We're definitely going to watch Honey Boy soon, I feel like. I think that one I will cry in. I don't know what else. I've been watching a lot of New Girl. And then I'm so embarrassed to like admit this to people, but I started watching the new Love Island.
What's going on? This tracks.
What's going on the island?
It's the USA one, so I don't particularly like the USA one. I prefer the Australian Love Island. But they're in Vegas on the rooftop of Caesar's Palace, and there's not really much going on right now because I've only watched like episode one. So I started school, so I haven't been watching a lot of stuff. Yeah, school started for me. So and then my kids are going back to school, so I've been really busy with like just like adult shit. So
bummer.
Get it?
Yeah.
Adult shit.
Yeah, I don't think there's anything else, unless you can think of anything that I've watched.
Oh, I can think of something, and I will take the wheel. If you may spin it over here, okay. Because you forgot the double feature at the drive-in we went to several days ago.
Oh fuck, yeah, I did
a double bill feature of Russell Crowe's Unhinged. and Mad Max Fury Road.
Ooh. Yes, that's right. Those are both new movies for me. So I know Fury Road came out like 5 years ago or something like that.
It's been a minute, yeah.
Yeah, but we saw the black and white version.
The chrome version?
Yeah. Right. Yeah. So I was kind of sad that I didn't get to see all the pretty colors.
The colors in that film are incredible.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I remember from the trailer, but I didn't get to see any of that. But it didn't make the film any less of what it was. It was still really, really good. I think at the like towards the end of it, I was literally sitting on the edge of the car.
Which is appropriate. Well, good to watch
it. Yeah, that's very fitting.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And Unhinged was like so fucking ridiculous.
Was it Unhinged?
Like, no, since they've announced the movie and marketed the movie, and while watching, I have only referred to Russell Crowe's character as Unhinged. Like, that, as far as I'm concerned, that is his name. And he wasn't. And in the credits,
yeah.
You don't get his name.
Russell Crowe.
So as far as you know, his name could be like Unhinged Johnson.
Mr. Unhinged.
The movie opens very, very strong, and then it just keeps at it throughout the entire movie. And it just gets even more ridiculous throughout. There you go, Connor.
Jesus Christ. For the audio listeners, Connor is pouring G Fuel. Are you mixing it with vodka? Is that what's happening in there?
Vodka.
In that glass?
Yeah.
What flavor is that? Is that the sherbet?
That's the sherbet, yeah.
It's the sherbet.
Oh, boy.
Homemade we're going Four Loko.
We're going to 3 hours.
Connor's not. We might.
I thought Unhinged was just fun. I think it knew what it was, which was just absurd. Big husky crow, dude, just driving fools down and crashing into them and
fucking killing people in diners. Like,
you remember that line in Into the Spider-Verse? Nick Cage has this great line in Spider-Verse where he goes, "Sometimes I burn a match all the way down to my hand just so I can feel something." The movie literally opens with Unhinged doing that. That's the first thing anybody does in the movie.
Oh, God.
To let you know, this boy's not on the hinge anymore.
Decidedly un.
He's, yeah.
Yeah, it's so ridiculous. It's extremely comical, to be completely honest.
Was that the intent?
I don't think it was supposed to be funny, but I thought the movie kind of like knew what it was. Like, it knew it was ridiculous. It's not played for laughs.
I think it had like a certain meaning to it that it's supposed to grab the attention of like people are having road rage and they're going crazy and people are texting and on the phone and they shouldn't, which is causing more havoc and whatnot. And I think it's supposed to have like the underlying meaning, but the ridiculousness of the movie, you can't really pay attention to that.
It's just like
the cautionary tale
movie.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was the most expensive anti-texting while driving PSA of all time.
Solid.
So go check it out at the drive-in. If you can drive to go watch it, do that. Because like I just wanted to drive like through the screen when it was over.
Oh, my gosh.
That with Mad Max. What a rip-roaring, diesel-burning time.
I would great love night. To just talk about that movie for 3 hours. Love Mad that Max. Film. Mm-hmm. Fury Road.
I believe they're doing another double feature with Unhinged at the drive-in with the first Fast and the Furious. So just a lot of great car.
Oh man,
car nights.
Car it's a lot stuff. Of high octane entertainment.
Yes,
I hand wave it.
I'm definitely gonna have to watch Mad Max again just so I can watch the color version.
Yeah,
I think that's a must.
Very rewatchable movie.
Mm-hmm.
Adam, what have you been watching?
Ooh, watching not a lot. I mean, in terms of TV, I mostly just watch whatever my wife turns on. If I'm going to be in front of a screen, I'm much more of a video gamer. Lately, I've been doing a lot of like art school stuff online. So I'm just watching like art classes, things like that. Mm-hmm. But she started rewatching Umbrella Academy because she forgot season one. And so she wants to watch that through. I was commenting on social media because someone was asking about the Umbrella Academy, and I'm not in love with it really. Like, I think it's fine, but that's my takeaway from Umbrella Academy. People are like, well, how do you feel about it? I'm like, it's fine.
It's fine.
But the show is better than the comics. I think the comics, I have very little redeeming quality other than Gabriel Ba is the artist, and he's incredible. He's incredible. He's a very talented artist, and the style that he employs for it is very interesting, and I think it's mostly just oversold because Gerard Way. But yeah, I'm not a big fan, but I do think it's a fine storyline. I do think it's good in terms of, like, it's a watchable show. Umbrella Academy is a watchable show, and she wants to get up to season two. So it's like, yeah, totally. She's rewatching Avatar as well, Last Airbender, mm-hmm. which I'm a big fan. I've been reading a lot, obviously, Survivor Song, which we're going to get to later. But I crank that out to get it out of the way. More to come later. But then I went back to basics, fantasy. Obviously, I read a lot of fantasy and sci-fi. I'm that kind of nerd. If there's any doubts out there, and fitting, I just saw Ursula K. Le Guin has a documentary that's being put out for free this week to watch, which she's very foundational, very important to the fantasy genre in general, especially for fantasy and sci-fi, especially as a woman author. She made a very big early impact on the sci-fi scene, and I started reading her listening to her Earthsea books, audiobook. Wizard of Earthsea is the first one, and it's actually narrated by Harlan Ellison, which I was very surprised by. Also a very well-known author. One of the most cantankerous men in the history of literature, who I know at one point was known for, he didn't like a publisher's review of his book or something, so he ended up mailing him 213 bricks and a dead gopher.
So it's petty, great, but it's great.
Great response. But I think he did all that over the span of four packages. I think the gopher was in the fourth box by itself. So those are some heavy boxes. But yeah, so far Wizard of Earthsea is very, very good. It feels like you can see a direct line between that and into like Robin Hobb's, like the Assassin's Apprentice, the Farseer trilogy, which are also very, very enjoyable, very huge ass books. The Wizard of Earthsea, I think, is like a 9-hour audiobook. I also had Survivor Song's audiobook that was somewhere around there too, not too far off. But the third book in the Farseer trilogy is a 38-hour audiobook read by Paul Bamer. So that one I'm going to buckle up for, but I'll get to that after I'm done with Miss Le Guin. But yeah, so that's lots of reading.
Twilight Sagas.
Yeah, that's a yep. In one go. Maybe I should stream me listening to that nonstop 38 hours.
I would tune in.
I might need to borrow some G Fuel, Connor. But
how is that cocktail down there, Connor?
It feels like I'm drinking straight diesel.
degreasing is insides.
I thought it would taste like Skittles or something.
You would hope.
Skittles and diesel, yeah.
It tastes like diesel. It just feels like my insides are now made of diesel.
Is it like diesel, like a diesel on a diesel running clown car, something like that? Maybe perhaps, yeah. Like a clown flavor?
They have a lot of brightly colored bumper stickers.
Yeah.
They do.
Connor, what have you been watching?
A lot of New Girl still. We're like probably towards the end of season 6. And I also watched Once Upon a Time in Mexico, the Robert Rodriguez film, the third in the Desperado series, the El Mariachi series. It's pretty good. You got a eyeless Johnny Depp with a pot leaf belt buckle. Pretty cool.
Very cool.
It's a fun movie. It's a fun movie. I like it. But I haven't really watched a lot. That's pretty much it. Oh, and I watched Bloodshot.
Bloodshot rules, right?
Yeah, it's all right. I wanted to like it more. I wish it was like a lot more violent. I feel like it was pretty tame just to settle for a PG-13 rating.
But not terrible, right?
No, not terrible.
Really? Taylor's really trying to pull Connor up on this one.
We saw Bloodshot.
We did?
Vin Diesel.
It had a really cool trailer, but it seems like a movie that like all the good stuff to see is actually in the trailer. Oh, like, that's what it felt like.
What is Bloodshot?
I was like waiting for him to turn into Bloodshot only for like 5 minutes.
He's like a sci-fi Bloodshot soldier.
Oh,
gets his face shot off and he comes in.
Apparently,
yeah, that was like one of the coolest things in the movie.
Right, and it's in the trailer.
Yeah, I wish it was more violent. It wasn't.
Also, he doesn't look like the comic book character, which is a small gripe because I never have read a Bloodshot comic book in my life. But he literally doesn't look like the character until for 3 seconds at the end of the film, which is like, why'd you bother making a Bloodshot?
Yeah.
I think my favorite part was the dancing scene.
For the sequel, obviously. You're going to get a Bloodshot cinematic universe.
There will be one.
Is Bloodshot Image or Valiant?
That is Valiant.
Yeah, the Valiant because universe. They are trying
to start the Valiant universe of.
They're trying movies. So hard. Like Valiant had some good content, but between that and like Man of War XO is Valiant, Ninja yeah. K.
And they were also apparently trying to get a Turok movie made over there.
That would be that. Okay, there's a couple of Turok IPs out there. There's a couple of Turok IPs. I think it's owned by Dynamite now. There is one Turok who actually I can't find it because there's a current run of Turok that is not the one that I'm looking for, of like it's the New World, right? Or it's sort of like the First Nations Turok kind of story, and then like the British people, the white dudes basically come and they bring the dinosaurs with them into the New World. So Turok becomes a dinosaur hunter because he's like fighting against the colonial power of the white dudes. And it's a really cool story, but I've only found the first volume. And then they started releasing a different Turok. And so if you're looking up in like on Comixology or something like that, and you're looking for the Dynamite Turok, the later one comes up, which is also a good storyline. I like it, but it's not the one that I wanted. I wanted to see the dudes like getting into sword fights with dinosaurs. That's what I really wanted. I want dinosaur sword fights. Dinosaurs. Can we just call it? Can we just make a Reely Scared production and call it Dinosaurs?
Yeah, make an original IP, and then you'll know where it's at all the time. You can make what you want to see in the world.
Dinosaurs.
I just remembered a couple more things I watched. I watched Random Acts of Violence.
All right.
Shudder. Jay Baruchel's latest movie. It's actually really fucking good. It's about a comic writer who's writing about like a real life serial killer. And a lot of people are pissed off about it. And he goes on this like publicity tour around the areas that the murders happened. And he like makes up like these murder scenes that didn't necessarily happen, but they start happening in real life, and the murderer comes back. It's really good, very violent, gory. I loved it. It's on Shudder. If you have time to check it out. And I also watched on HBO. It's called The Vow. It's a docuseries about this sex cult that happened. It was ESP, Nexium.
Yeah, Nexium.
Yeah. A couple of actresses from Smallville were actually a part of it and actually arrested, like, later. It's crazy. The first episode is up on HBO, and it's actually nuts.
Okay.
I was just like, holy shit. So I'm excited to see more from that.
Yeah, I forgot there is one film that I watched 3 times this week, and it is the new added Netflix movie. It's not a Netflix movie, but 1BR. I watched 3 times this week.
Jessica, that's a lot of 1BR.
There it is.
I think at that point it's 3BR.
Yeah. It is very, very good. So I watched it about 3 times. In my free time the other day. So
1BR, baby, top 10 trending movies on Netflix. You love to see it.
Number two right now.
Yep. Number two, it beat Bloodshot on iTunes. Now it's time to beat Project Power on Netflix. Coming for you, Levitt.
I did see Project Power. It was okay.
It was fun. It was a fun movie.
Was it watchable?
It wasn't the greatest thing in the world.
It was watchable.
It was a fun time.
Jamie Foxx is an attractive man. Joseph Gordon-Levitt also not a bad looker.
What's not?
Yeah, you got to see a lot of them doing them stuff. Actually, the actress that played I can't remember her name. The lead actress on that was actually very impressive. She was very good. I liked the scenes where she rapped and things like that. Very cool.
Sam, what are you watching?
The scene like rapping for it, Jamie Foxx was actually like, it was just an enjoyable movie, and I loved that scene. Yeah.
What have you watched? What have you witnessed?
Well, I just finished the first two seasons of Twin Peaks.
Yes.
For the first time, as you know.
Yes.
You've been very privy to slow descent into Twin Peaks madness. Which culminated watching Fire Walk with Me.
I'm still finishing that film.
We could go a whole 3 hours on just Twin Peaks and the movie. I spent a lot of time doing what I did through all of Twin Peaks, which was just kind of uncomfortably laughing at all of them. I do need to hunt down the missing pieces after finding out that like all of my favorites were in all of the scenes that were cut from the movie. So I will be going back to do that. But so I watched seasons 1 and 2, and then the movie. I watched that countdown about the app that predicts your death. It wasn't terrible.
Oh.
It really wasn't terrible.
It was watchable.
Very, very, very low expectations for it. But compared to some of the other things that I've watched in the last couple weeks, I didn't actually hate it. So that was, I'll give it like a thumbs up, I guess. We watched 1BR. I did sit down and watch 1BR the other day. Not having, you know, any other context for it besides you guys talking about it on the show. I obviously avoided the conversations because I didn't want any of it to be spoiled for me.
Yeah.
And had to kind of give it a pause for my poor kid, the cat. The cat kind of came out of left field. It was an intense watch, but it was a good one. And then last night I watched Hell House LLC.
Yeah.
Which I avoided for years because of that god-awful title. If they would have just kept it at Hell House, I would have been far more inclined to sit down and watch. But it was terrifying. It like actually very thoroughly creeped me out, where I was turning lights on when it was over. One of, I think, the best found footage movies I've seen in a very long time, just because it was effective, about a group that runs a haunted house, and they try to set up this year's haunted house in an abandoned hotel that's been abandoned for like 30 years, and they're exploring, and then they see a bunch of pentagrams carved in the walls in the basement, and like, you know, it was all just sunshine and rainbows for those guys.
Yeah.
They turned it into a trilogy, so I do look forward to watching the other two movies. And kind of see where that goes, because if they're anything like the first one, it'll be another couple sleepless nights, which I'm all signed up for. And then just before I joined you guys, I watched Better Watch Out, a fun little holiday horror movie with the kids from The Visit.
That one's good.
Which I would give it an award for the most deceiving trailer in like the entire world. Because I totally thought it was going to be one thing, just to have the carpet ripped out from underneath me, and sat there and went, wait, what?
Yeah.
But thoroughly, thoroughly enjoyed that one. As far as anything else, I am currently, as I said, drinking all of the Twin Peaks Kool-Aid, and I am reading The Secret History of Twin Peaks, and a book by Chuck Klosterman for work, just to try to bring some fresh perspective.
You're more Twin Peaks literate than I am at this point. I think you're going to be.
I don't know anything about it. I literally, I've heard the name, but I literally know nothing about it.
Adam,
you could have watched it. And still might not know anything about it. It's David Lynch at his most aggressive. I would
say at his wackiest, and it is gold. It is incredible.
You can watch Twin Peaks, but it doesn't mean you know much of it. It's a ride you are not in control of. And Matt's just squirming. Apparently, he wants to know, Connor, have you finished Perry Mason? Hasn't done it. Sorry to say. Still not parried that Mason yet.
He did parry the Mason. Dodged it. Got him.
Got him. Why don't we look at some horror movie news? What do you guys think?
Let's do it.
I think it's about that time.
Yeah.
We I'm sensing a longer one tonight than we've made it this far and are just now getting to the horror movie news of the week.
Sorry.
I love it. As long as I'm having a good time, I love it. And hopefully you know what I mean? It's the Dave Lynch thing, man. Like, I like doing it. Hopefully someone will watch it. And if not, oh well. So thanks everybody for watching it. Let's see. So we already kind of covered the 1BR thing because I wanted to shout them out for doing so well on Netflix. But if you guys at home haven't seen 1BR yet, I don't know what you're doing. If you listen to this show, have you not just checked it out of morbid curiosity at this point? But go check out 1BR on Netflix. Give it some support. It is blowing up over there, and I love to see it. Speaking of Netflix, what's not blowing up over there, sadly, a show I liked very much. I am not okay with this after one season has unfortunately been canceled by Netflix. They were apparently in pre-production on a second season. They were planning to go forward with it, but for reasons that they cited only as being related to COVID, they've just decided to not go forward with the show. Any of you guys watched I Am Not Okay With This before?
Yes, and it was so good.
Nope.
I think this COVID, like the COVID reason they gave, is just an excuse to cancel another good show.
It has to be.
So they can push out more shitty reality TV shows like The Circle and all that.
It probably is a symptom of how the unending cycle at which Netflix churns out content. They're like, well, we're going to make this, this, and this, and this, and this. So we can't go backwards and finish that, unfortunately. I'm guessing.
Also, they just bought Martin Scorsese's next film. That's probably like $250 million. So they're cutting everything again. Some of their lesser known titles. Because I know a lot of people didn't watch I'm Not Okay With This, but just canceling shit to fund.
That's clearly there has to be something more than that going on, because it's not a good business model to take something that actually has potential and quality and then to cancel it. I would guess if they are citing COVID as a reason, it's probably more a function of the effects that COVID has on their viewership. And so more people are going to be at home watching Netflix that maybe were not at this time last year. So instead of being more our demographic watching what's on Netflix, it's going to be older demographic who's more accustomed to certain kinds of things that they used to be able to catch on MTV or whatever. And so even though there are definitely shows that we would view as crappy shows or shitty content or whatever, it's probably just feels dated to us is why we don't like it, because they're catering to an older audience, because their audience is aging exponentially with a lot of people in their 60s being at home more bored. And obviously as we continue down this path of monopolizing industries like cable, it's just getting more and more unreliable. Like TV is, it's all the same. It's all crappy. So there's more people just turning to streaming services. And so you just end up with more 60-year-olds watching TV. So they're making 60-year-old TV shows on Netflix. And unfortunately, older people have more money than us. So they win.
Yeah.
Netflix has the record, too, just like pulling up that stuff. Anything that isn't Stranger Things, it seems at this point.
Right.
It's very hard to make it past like two seasons on Netflix. You can get your idea greenlit, like they'll make anything, but they're not going to make it for long, it seems to be.
Lucifer seems to be going pretty long.
Well, it started on cable.
Yeah, but now it's a Netflix show, right?
Yeah, but like so much of that show exists before Netflix enters the picture.
It has
I think it was three or four seasons before Netflix snagged it.
Mm-hmm. And so it's a very safe movie.
That was a new season.
Yeah, Lucifer, Connor, is what we're talking about.
Oh, yeah, they only gave it one more season. So even then, they were like, we're not pushing this too much more. So
I'm still surprised that they would even give that show another season when it already had so many short shows before then. and
it was a really safe move because the fan base was already very large,
and yeah, the viewership was there.
Yeah, it was already there. They didn't have to market it. Like, it marketed itself.
Lucifer one more season after by NBC or Fox or whatever.
Yeah,
all those people are going to come and sign up for Netflix and watch the final season. So
it was like the fifth season of Samurai Jack. Like, Cartoon Network didn't need to sell that. Once they said season 5 of Samurai Jack, literally everyone was like, all right, Mike, I'm in. I love Samurai Jack. Best cartoon, NA.
Canceling anything is just an excuse. It's a $1 billion company. They're right up there with Disney, you know, so it's just for them to just cancel a show and say it's the COVID is just an excuse just to cancel it.
It's the COVID.
What's the cheap way? It's the easy way out.
Yeah, they can't. I didn't make a note of it because it's not a horror show. And as we know, we strictly talk only horror movies and nothing else at all times. But they canceled another show alongside this too. So this is probably the first in a series of announcements. Just saving all that cash for the Stranger Things.
They probably do need to like save up money to buy like big name stuff just because they're going to be, you know, competition's only going to get heavier with like Disney Plus and other streaming services. So they probably need to like save up money for big bill IPs or something, I would guess.
Well, in this year, their stock was higher than Disney. So at one point this year, they were actually worth more than Disney.
So, yeah, but they don't have the Mandalorian or Disney princesses.
There's no Netflix princesses, it's got to be said.
Not yet.
Maybe. Not yet.
Maybe.
Yeah, 11. Eleven. 11.
I can't wait for that show.
Psychic princesses. Disney doesn't even have that.
Brian Singer's X-Men series.
They do have
the bikini bottom on a nude butt, but they will. They can't show a butt, but they will stream Brian Singer's work.
I don't know who Brian Singer is.
That dude's a butt.
Kyle Rapist.
Are you talking about Disney?
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, well, they'll go full hog on Chris Pine.
Oh. Oh, yeah, watch the Outlaw King.
And we did watch the Outlaw King.
I would love to go full hog on Chris Pine.
Strong.
That movie is so good, by the way. So good. Have you guys seen
Outlaw
it?
King? That's the one that's sort of people are saying is like a spiritual successor to like Braveheart, right? Is that one?
I could see that.
Like just in the way that it was produced.
About what, Robert the Bruce?
Yeah.
I've heard it was very good.
It is very good. Aaron Taylor Johnson does his best performance in any movie in this film. Just absolutely spectacular.
He does have a great shot, as Jessica pointed out, in battle where he's drenched in blood and he goes.
he does it twice. It's a very like gory, blood like involved, very violent film. It's very, and Florence Pugh is in it too. She's amazing.
Good for you.
You have.
She was in Midsommar, right?
Midsommar.
She's a pretty chick.
She's great.
The only thing I've ever seen her in, and she was impressive in that film.
She was also great in Little Women.
Yes, she was. Very she different was. Film.
Yes.
Very she good.
Was Little she was Women.
Very good in Outlaw King, too, I think.
And Fighting With My Family, my favorite pro wrestling biopic to date.
I love that movie.
She's good in everything, man.
She is very good.
Pugh brings it. We were talking about Netflix. Speculating what else they're making, I'll tell you what else they're making because we got some info on it today, which is the live-action Resident Evil TV series on Netflix. And I thought
that doesn't look live-action.
Distinct observation, Adam. Now, I was kind of all for this, but this is they've released a synopsis on it today. It's eight 1-hour-long episodes, and the synopsis of it is when the Wesker kids move to New Raccoon City, the secrets they uncover might just be the end of everything. Resident Evil, a new live-action series based on Capcom's legendary survival horror franchise, is coming to Netflix. The Wesker kids, hello?
Yeah, okay. I just want to say, like, that, like, the secrets they uncover is going to be my dad is a horrible human being.
No, the secret number one is going to be they're adopted, because Wesker is and has always been a genetic mutant alien zombie man. Like, that's kind of his thing, right? Like, rhino charges don't come from normal humans, and that's all he does. He's just hands through chests everywhere. Clearly, he was born this way. Thank you, Lady Gaga.
It's going to be a continuation of the movie series. Is what?
Oh, really?
Yeah. Is the writer of the movie, or not the writer, but there's people from the original like movie series they're making this.
Was that all made by like a single team? Because they all feel very different, and like the quality just
they all have the same
one director. Of those.
Yeah, there's only one that doesn't have the same director, and that's I think the third one. Everything else is WS. But it's a continuation, so
that is a poor investment. Not good.
The secrets they uncover, it's not a secret to the audience, because you know they're the Wesker kids, so I don't understand.
I don't think when you think of Resident Evil fans, I don't think literally any of them would say like if you say, do you like Resident Evil? And like, yeah. And if they say the games or the movies, I think most of them would be like, let's try to forget about the movies. Like
movies.
Like, we just want to see, like, I don't know, Chris Redfield's arms doing crazy things that they do, because he just punches people apart with those things. Like, that's all I want. That's all I want. I just want Dave Bautista to be Chris Redfield, and I just wanted to punch humans apart for 2.5 hours, and I would watch that movie all day.
I would tune into that. Sam, you play the Resident Evil games. Do I have that right?
I played almost all of Biohazard. All of the other ones were just a bit out of my range.
So you played the most recent one?
Yeah, I got all the way up to, I think, almost the end, and then just for some reason set it down for something else and never came back to it. I would really love to see an adaptation of Biohazard, just because it was, from what my experience with Resident Evil was, such a tonal shift. And like the
that was number 8, right?
That was 7.
7. 8's coming out. Yeah.
8's on its way. But I thought that, you know, the backwoods, bayou, swampy kind of area was really atmospheric. In the
Did they go back to the Magini for that one?
I don't think so.
That's just it was 4 and 5 is when they tended to refer to the zombies as Magini.
Gotcha. No, these were like mold monsters, which made me very, you know, apprehensive of any damp, musty basement. But it was really claustrophobic for the first half, and then it, as you kind of open up and explore the grounds, it pans out and widens a little bit, but the first couple hours were really intense, and that was something that I was super into. Yeah. As far as like a Netflix show, I don't know, especially if so much of it is already established. Like, I feel like you would really have to be thinking outside of the box on
that. It is established in such a poor foundation, no less.
Right.
Like, they planted that tree in the sand.
They should have just started fresh and
just give us Leon. Give us Chris Redfield. Like, doing actual Leon Kennedy and Chris Redfield things.
Just give us something from the games we like.
I had fun with the Resident Evil game.
Which one?
Playing back in the day?
Whichever one was that Valley View where you had the gun.
You're talking about an arcade cabinet.
Like a light gun? Dude, they're dope. Light gun games are dope.
So much fun.
I've played so many Resident Evil games. I haven't played the most recent ones, but I've played like Resident Evil like 1 all the way up through like the 5 and Outbreak. I don't know where Outbreak falls, and then the Chronicles, one of the Raccoon City Chronicles, I think. One of those ones. So I've been a big fan of the games for a long time, and the movies are they're fun to watch, but I just want them distanced from the Resident Evil IP, because like there's like so much is like so many of the characters are just so cool. Like I said, Chris Redfield and his biceps are legendary. Jill Valentine, super good.
Yeah.
You know, Wesker is just a cool bad guy, or he was before he
got kicked out.
Well, he kept being alive. Like, that was the confusing thing with Wesker. Like, how are you not dead? I've killed you in literally 4 games already. Stop.
He's like a bug monster with Matrix powers. He can do whatever he wants.
I guess. But yeah. I mean, I would love to see more of something more true to the games with the Resident Evil, because I think it's definitely a folly to try to build on that kind of foundation, because it is on shaky ground.
Yeah, they, as soon as like whatever the last Resident Evil one, I think it was literally called like the last one or something. Resident Evil the last. like almost as soon as it was out, they had announced they were going to relaunch and do a new movie series that was closer to the games. And James Wan, I think, was attached to it at first, and he's not anymore. So it's already a perilous production history. I read this and I thought, I mean, is this canonical to the games? Like,
no. Not if there's Wesker kids.
Don't exist. But that's why I was like, is this going to be in universe with the games as a new story or something?
Unless they're like test tube clone babies and Wesker's like, yes, I'm your father. And then they're like, you killed my dad. And it's like, well, actually, your dad cooked you in the oven. And that's why you're born when you were. Also, your dad turned into a giant mutant beast thing. And though his shades were cool, we had to put him down.
Secrets uncovered.
Calling the plot. These are test tube kids.
I mean, that's a pretty Wesker thing to do, though. I could see for everything sure. You said being true, actually. So, I don't know. I guess we'll... I mean, there's no way I'm not going to check that.
Guess we'll see.
This news, I know Sam's going to be very excited for this news item here. We got some Robert Eggers news on his new film. There he is directing the great Robert Pattinson on the set of Lighthouse. His follow-up film, a Viking revenge film called The Northman, is casted and entering production. It has a crazy cast. Nicole Kidman, Alexander Skarsgård, Anya Taylor-Joy, Bill Skarsgård, Willem Dafoe, and reportedly is casting Bjork as a witch.
Whoa.
All right, I'm signed up. I'm signed up. Sorry. You had me done at Robert Eggers, like already signed up.
I haven't seen Lighthouse yet. I want to. Man. I have to watch it with the right people, though. Like, I'm not just gonna like sit here with like a towel over my head watching it like on my monitor just in the dark. Like, I need to watch it with somebody.
I think you will like the Lighthouse.
You'll love it. I'm sure I will. And that cast just seals the deal for me. You already know The Witch was one of my all-time favorite horror movies. The Lighthouse was incredible for being something so zany and different. And Pattinson and Dafoe were incredible. So I will follow him into any weird chamber he wants to go into and know that it'll be superb.
Yeah. Robert Eggers has proved his strength is making these bizarre time period horror, pseudo horror films. We're going back ever with Vikings.
Ooh, Vikings?
Viking revenge.
Ooh,
the best kind of revenge. It sounds great. This is like the biggest cast he's worked with thus far. I mean,
those are big names.
Yeah, that's a lot of money on that.
Yeah, Robert Eggers is totally, I think, won over the industry or whoever's paying the bills or making decisions at this point, because this feels like a blank check project to me.
Right.
If he's got that kind of like pull, it might just be a thing where everyone's just like, yeah, I want to do it. You know, like they're just not even talking about.
I wouldn't blame them. You know, the minute someone says Robert Eggers wants to do a movie, when and where, I'll be there.
Like, no, I don't think anybody on that list needs to care about a check coming in this week. And so if they were just like, yeah, I want to do this Viking witch thing, then I'm sure everyone was just like, who's the witch? And he's like, Bjork? It's like, that's the only person that he even paid. All he has to do is say, Bjork's a witch. And everyone was like, I want in on that. Like, let's go.
Is that really acting for her, though?
No, that's the best thing. Just like The Rock hasn't had to act in the last 10 years, but he's great. So Bjork doesn't need to act either. She's a witch.
She's just going to show up, do her thing, collect a check, and go home.
Yeah.
I'd love to see Bjork enter the Fast and Furious franchise, though. We're bringing it up. I love to see how fast. There's nothing to say that they couldn't meet a witch in Fast and the Furious. Cursed cars.
The Fast and the Furious witch. She goes just so quick. Just zooming all over the goddamn place like a turbo-powered Baba Yaga.
Yeah. Yeah, hit the nitrous on the broomstick, just blast
chicken
off
feet go night. Crazy.
How you doing down there, Connor? How's the spine treat you?
Very good.
Very good.
Try not good. Just don't move your neck, Kenny.
Yeah.
Good. Yeah, there's nothing not to love about the Northman. I can't wait to see that. Mm-hmm.
Was there an ETA on that?
No, I mean, they're just now apparently entering production, which is promising because some films have struggled to do that this year. So they're probably shooting it in some country that isn't worrying about COVID anymore because they figured it out already. Yeah, anyone but this one. So they're probably in some strange Scandinavian dirty place that Robert Eggers loves to go to.
Cool.
On the filthy, demented shores of some beach somewhere.
Sweden.
Going back to Netflix, got a peek at a show that I'm looking forward to. That is the Haunted Bly Manor. Bly Manor? Bly Manor? I think it's
Bly.
I think it's Bly Manor.
Bly
Manor. Recently revealed to not just be an adaptation of The Turn of the Screw by Henry James, with a number of his stories adapted all at once. So they're kind of castle rocking this thing from the sound of it. I've actually never, I still to this day have not watched The Haunting of Hill House on Netflix.
Oh, it's so
good. It's good.
It's so
Taylor.
I know.
Oh, you're in trouble.
Taylor, you can just sit here and give me shit for not seeing Mad Max but not have watched Hill House.
I've watched the whole entire show like 3 or 4 times. It's so fucking good.
It's incredible.
I've been trying to tell him for a long time.
It's everything.
Well, you haven't watched it.
It's not my thing.
I've only heard it's the best. I've started it twice, and then for whatever reason, I just always fall out of it.
It was good. It was good.
It's beautiful.
It was good. It was more than watchable. Watchable plus.
You watch Unhinged.
Saw the number on the ad.
So yeah, I put the thing in there. They put out this. You can't really read it too well from here, but a ad like a wanted paper ad that says "Live-in nanny seeking au pair for 2 perfectly splendid children at the Bly Manor residence. Manor is located on the English countryside. Position begins immediately. Call this number posted on it to schedule an interview." And I thought it'd be cool if I called it here on the show, but it's a UK number and I can't figure out how to get through.
Oh, here, let me try.
It's a plus 44.
Here, I got it.
Connor's trying it out. Hold on, see if we hear it. It's further than I got.
Hi, you've reached the English family at Bly Manor. I'm not here right now. If you're calling about the open nanny position, interviews will be conducted by our Uncle Henry in 5 days. It'll be perfectly splendid. We can't wait to meet you.
I can't wait to meet you, Connor.
What is it?
Better start packing.
They said, when did the ad come out? Was this today or yesterday?
I believe this was yesterday that the ad came out.
All right, so that means when you called it yesterday, it said 5 days they'll contact you. So that's 4 more days. That means a trailer's probably coming out in 4 days.
Yeah, that's the popular theory.
I would second that. I know that there was a Vanity Fair article that made its rounds on, I want to say, Monday, that had first look photos of the cast and stuff like that. I loved Hill House. Everything that Flanagan has done has been great. So I have, very, very high expectations. Really looking forward to a late 2020 release on that, hopefully just in time for Halloween.
Yeah, they've said it's coming out in fall. They just still haven't put a date on it, I believe.
Halloween.
Let me see. The poster. Oh, you can't. Let's see. We'll find out in real time. What did it say at the bottom of there? To kill my banner. This fall. Okay.
This fall.
Not a very specific, but it's got to be coming soon then.
But if I remember correctly, the Hill House came out around Halloween. So I feel like this one will probably come out around Halloween.
I gotta do is commit to watching that damn Hill House here. So I can jump right into Bly Manor.
I won't watch
it. Did you say you didn't see Mad Max in your chastising, Sam? Is that what I heard?
You heard that correctly.
Fury Road or any of them?
No, and I own Fury Road.
None.
It's on like a 300 title watch list. And then Taylor yelled at me, so I moved it up a little bit. And then I had every intent of watching it and got sucked into my horror movie marathon that I've been doing.
Let's have a drive-in double feature at Sam's place, and we're going to watch Lighthouse and Fury Road.
We'll do the black and chrome edition of Mad Max, and then we'll chase it with the Lighthouse in black and white.
Unless Jessica's going to be there, then we need to watch it with color.
And then we'll somehow watch the Lighthouse in color too.
And then we'll just top it off with Blade Runner 2049. We need more colors.
Oh, what's this? One day ago, the Haunting Instagram account uploaded an image. What appears to also be that paper ad, but it's
underwater.
It's underwater and like ripped up or something. So they're.
I don't know if you guys can see it.
Yeah, I don't know how tangible. Oh, you can't see it. Yeah. The audio listeners probably not so much, but
and then they posted it after that. They posted a picture of the manor itself.
Yeah, So they're doing some spooky viral marketing over there, and I always love to see that. So that's something to look forward to, and I'm looking forward to it. I'll watch Hill House first because I know I owe it to myself to check it out. So I will get on that.
It's just on the left side of the actual wanted ad. So the left side and then the right side.
Oh, okay. Some more newspaper picks. Something else we got, something I didn't know was happening in the first place, and it's apparently not having a great time, is the Texas Chainsaw Massacre reboot. Gets a new director 1 week into production, starting all over. Ryan and Andy Tohill were directing it for Legendary Studios, which I thought was an unusual fit for this. And it'll be now helmed by director David Blue Garcia. They're scrapping all the footage. So there's never mind putting it all in the trash. Something really upsetting happened there. And also just thought it was interesting that Elsie Fisher is starring in this from 8th grade.
Yikes. The bold parts of
little Elsie Fisher.
But Fede Alvarez is behind it. He's producing it. And I have complete faith in Fede. He's really good. Don't Breathe, Evil Dead.
Both of those were very strong.
The Girl in the Spider's Web was okay.
Didn't make that. Yeah, that was
watchable.
It was conceivable.
Yeah. I think that has more to do with Sony than it has to do with talent.
It was totally one of those classic studio blunders for sure.
Yeah. But yeah, I have faith in it. Obviously, they didn't like what they saw, which at least they were like, oh, this is probably going to be shit, so let's start over.
A promising start.
At least they didn't just go forward with it, like, oh, maybe we can salvage it and post. They were like,
yeah. Right.
Bless your heart.
Bless you, Jessica.
Obviously, we do. Blessings abound. We knew all these slashers were coming back in a big bad way after Halloween did so well. I just didn't know this movie. I didn't know about this one specifically. Texas Chainsaw is a kind of a weird one that never fully went away. Like I know 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago, they put out like a prequel to Texas Chainsaw Massacre called Leatherface. It's very bad. I didn't see it.
Let me go ahead and frame it for you. So there's Ryan is brother, and there's like this, the brother is like huge, and you're like, oh, that's Leatherface. And they escape they kidnap this girl, and they're trying to escape from this mental institution. And there's a twist where it's not the giant dude who you think is Leatherface the whole time, so he gets shot in the head. It's this scrawny dude, the other brother, who is actually Leatherface. And you're just like, that doesn't make any sense. This Leatherface, giant dude, and you're just going to frame it as
Yes, maybe he's like Joel Schumacher's Bane. You think about this?
Maybe he just gets a membership to Planet Fitness.
Yeah, maybe he just beats up. That's not a gym.
No. It's a bad movie. And it's a...
Don't they give you pizza at Planet Fitness? So that probably is where he went.
They give you bagels and pizza.
And Tootsie Rolls. You really can just go there and just bulk up on just sweets and carbs if you want.
I've never been into a gym. If you couldn't tell.
If they feed you hunks of human flesh, perhaps that is where Leatherface went.
Yeah, if they did, I would get a membership.
Probably I'd pull my back out while going up a flight of stairs. So.
Got to get on that Leatherface regime.
Not a stairmaster. You are a stair peasant.
So that's what we got for Texas Chainsaw so far. We'll check back in a couple months, I'm sure. Speaking of something else I didn't really know was happening or didn't expect to see, and I love this picture. It's about to be right in your fucking face. Here he comes. Yeah.
Oh my god. Disgusting.
We're getting apparently a new adaptation of The Thing coming from Blumhouse and John Carpenter himself. He revealed this at a Fantasia panel. He very offhandedly just kind of mentioned, oh yeah, Blumhouse is making a new one and I'm involved somehow, but he wouldn't say if it was like a remake or a prequel, like the one from, I think that was 2011 or whatever it was. He wouldn't reveal how it relates to the other movies. We've sang the praises of Blumhouse on here plenty of times. So there's no real reason for me to doubt them, but I love John Carpenter's The Thing. Love it. Love it. Jessica does not love it, as you can see. I'm sure you have not seen John Carpenter's The Thing, but it is, we talk about body horror on this film. This is the,
can't handle body horror.
This is the,
I have not like, seen eight, it.
No, Adam, I think you would like The Thing. Take another look. Sexless man after your own heart.
The second glance.
That shirtless photo of me?
Pilfered from his old Facebook.
I don't doubt this at all. I mean, John Carpenter's involved in it. It's Blumhouse. I mean, they already rebooted or made a sequel to Halloween, so
yeah,
they prove they can still capture John Carpenter's presence already.
Yeah, so. What do you think of that 2000? I think it was 2011. What do you think of that prequel they did?
It's bad.
Do you see that one? Yeah, it's Carpenter's Thing is a remake, so it's not as if this world or the story is exempt from being remade. But I don't know about doing it. I guess I'll have to see what it is and he's attached to it, so that's something. I kind of hope it isn't taking place in an Antarctic base as the last two have. I mean, if you're going to do this, I guess you can spin it out any direction you want, but I'd just come up with something a little bit different than we've already seen two times now. I mean, the Carpenter one is such a classic. I think probably one of my favorite horror films of all time. And we'll watch it sometime, Jessica. We'll watch The Thing. I said it's one of. Love The Thing. It is a goopy, soupy, bloody, spidery time. It's great. I think it's got an ingenious.
It's a booch of a time is what you're saying.
catch me after an jalapeno booch.
that's the toilet times after jalapeno booch.
That is so accurate.
You are it. It's weird. You drink it and you just become repulsive. I don't.
It's weird. True.
Speaking of images I love to just throw
torture
up,
me with.
Just love to throw up on the screen without warning, and you don't know what's going to be. And Adam, I'm specifically happy you're here for this. We got into this last time you were here. Kevin Smith pitches potential of Tusk 2.
I like that you said the term throw up before you posted it, because that movie is so barfing.
In his own words, quality. there's a version of Tusk 2 that you do where you cut to the present and somebody else gets sucked into the spider's web. The house, you hear stories, and when you get to the house, the new Howard Howe is Wallace, who's gotten out of the walrus trappings and is obviously disturbed by his entire ordeal and is now doing it to others. So there's a way to do Tusk 2 where Justin becomes Michael Parks' character. He becomes a new Howard Howe. So yeah, that's possible. Tusk 2 is possible. I've thought about it. What do you think about Tusk 2? I say I saw you cheering down there.
The best news I've heard all day.
Yes.
That is something that I never thought I wanted. Totally, totally happy. Very, very blessed. Thank you, Kevin Smith.
Yeah. I want this badly.
If he can give me Moose Jaws before he does Tusk 2, like, I'm golden.
What the fuck? Kind of a spoiler, though. Tusk 2 comes after Moose Jaws. We know the walrus is defeating Moose Jaws. Because he said the walrus might be in Moose Jaws. The Moose Jaws.
Oh.
Maybe that's how he gets out of the walrus suit.
It just rends the suit with its venomous antlers. I want to see a moose with giant venom sacs on its antlers. So
I'm so afraid to ask.
I don't have any questions. I just don't want to talk about it.
No, so you do know he scrapped the original plot for Moose Jaws, right? He came on SCN Live last week and talked about his future film.
I missed that.
Yeah, because Jane, Silent Bob were originally going to die in Moose Jaws, but he's bringing them back for...
And he's just scrapping everything.
And Clerks 3, so he was like, I can't kill them in Moose Jaws because I'm doing those. He's rewriting Moose Jaws.
Page 150, he said, so.
You better not bail on Moose Jaws.
He said after the Clerks films, that's his next project. He wants to knock out Mallrats and Clerks 3, and then he's going on to Moose Jaws. That's what he said.
Good man.
I'm gonna throw up.
And then Tusk 2.
He could wait Tusk a little 2. Bit if he wanted to. I think it would be fine.
And then there was at one time he was going to do an animated film about a giant, it was something about the apocalypse.
I mean, you just said the two things that will make me watch anything is cartoon. I'll watch any cartoon. An apocalypse. I'll watch any apocalypse.
There was a giant Christ-like creature. Voice Foxworthy.
Oh. You lost me. I didn't think you could do it.
Yeah, it was wild. I can't remember the name of it, but I think he totally scrapped that idea.
I got a question for you. Over under, we get Bratzies and Moose Jaws.
Bratzies? I'm gonna say no. I don't think the Bratzies thing paid off well for Smith, so I don't think they're coming back. I think he's gonna stay behind the directors. Stay in that director's chair and just get that walrus right in frame. A beautiful walrus picture.
Yeah.
But I hope the walrus does have Moose Jaws.
I agree with Jessica.
Hey, I'm with you. You think Kevin Smith and animated, I'm going to be there for the He-Man sequel series later this year, whenever it is. So.
I like it.
Don't touch the wire, my friend.
I have the new wire in. I don't know what it is.
I guess we got to find out what else you can't touch over there. I've been having some tech issues on this show the past couple weeks. We'll figure it out.
I'm watching the show.
However, let's see. What else we got? Oh, Josh Boone, director of New Mutants, has something else coming down the pipe. A book I haven't read. Again, it's one of those things that's been on the list for ages. Adam, you might have read it. His adaptation of The Stand, Stephen King's The Stand. Have you read The Stand, Adam?
Whoopi. Mother Abigail, I'm guessing.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've read The Stand recently, actually.
So what? So they are making, I believe it's for, it's for CBS All Access. They're making a series of it, premiering in December. As you saw, Alexander Skarsgård is Randall Flagg. Whoopi Goldberg as Mother Abigail. It'll also include Nat Wolff, James Marsden, Greg Kinnear, Amber Heard, Marilyn Manson, and more.
Oh, wow.
I love that Marilyn Manson's in it.
If Marilyn Manson has to be trash. Marilyn Manson had like the character trash, trash can man. Has to be. Because or the kid. There's weird shit that happens in The Stand. Not the least of which is a dude getting butt fucked with a gun barrel. But that does happen though. However, the circumstances are even weirder than just that fact alone. Like, it gets crazier with the characters involved. But I guarantee that Marilyn Manson is either going to be a character called the Trash Can Man or the Kid. There's no in between.
He's so good. He was in this movie called Let Me Make You a Martyr. And
Marilyn Manson?
Yeah. And he's so good in it. He's terrifying in it.
That's because he's a weird motherfucker.
I'm so excited that he's in it because the other names don't really.
James Marsden is awesome.
He's
nice. No, he's awesome. He's
good friend to a hedgehog.
Love him.
He's all right. I mean, I feel like he's just like, but Marilyn Manson, you throw that name in a Stephen King adaptation, I'm like, all right, I'll check it out.
Most Stephen King adaptations, I think, are fairly garbaggio. So I've
been loving everything since.
Well, yeah, there's a lot of them.
Andy Muschietti's It chapters are great.
That's true. The It movies are good, very good. The newer ones.
I thought Pet Cemetery was okay.
It was okay.
And I've liked what Mike Flanagan's done.
I don't know what Mike Flanagan's
like. Mastered the art of the Stephen King adaptation. He's doing what was it? Revival. He's doing Revival next. From
he did Gerald King movies. Something else Stephen King, didn't he?
He did Doctor Sleep.
Doctor Sleep.
Yeah.
Superb.
I didn't see that.
Loved Doctor Sleep. Loved The Outsider.
I actually don't read a lot of Stephen King. I don't like his writing for the most part. However, I will say again, I will reiterate that Dark Tower is my favorite book series of all time. But his other books are kind of hand wave.
That movie.
Well, he's apparently that written
movie didn't that happen. Movie with that actor.
No.
It's the Dark Towers movie.
No.
Not watchable.
Not unwatchable. Absolutely unwatchable. I was
Matthew McConaughey as
Man in Black, Randall Flagg.
Yeah.
No. I think the
movie was at least a little bit good from that.
I actually like Matthew McConaughey as Randall Flagg. I thought that was a good call.
Yeah.
That's what I mean. Like, it was a total waste of him because
he matches like the description perfectly, actually, and like he has the good body language and stuff. I really liked it. I liked Idris Elba as Roland of Gilead. It really problematizes his relationship and the character building around Susanna's character, which would be very hard to do like an actual like arc of the Dark Tower, just because so much of it is a commentary on racism and her coming to terms with both Eddie and Roland's character as authority figures in a way, as white men, as a black woman from the 20s, 30s, maybe a little bit later than that. So they would really problematize that, but otherwise I was with the rest of the general Dark Tower community when they said Idris Elba as Roland of Gilead. We were all like, let's see it. Like we're on board for it. But
what do you think of the potential of a Stand series?
Let's see it. It sounds like there's a lot of good names attached to it. The Stand, I thought, was pretty good. I think The Stand serves really well as a world-building exercise for Stephen King. The story is there, but I didn't find it entirely interesting. I did read it at the beginning of the whole COVID thing. I read it like in February of this year, so that was kind of apropos. But in terms of a super flu kind of a story, I liked it. I did. Way better than Survivor Song. So,
nobody gets fucked like yet.
I know.
Oh my god!
It just killed the mood for me.
Your immersion was ruined. Yeah. Well, we'll see. I guess The Stand is always. I've always heard great things about The Stand. It's one of those. I guess similar to the Hill House show. It's one of those things I keep saying, I'll get around to,
It's one of the, it's one of the best works I think of his that I've read for sure. I also read his foray into more traditional fantasy, Eyes of the Dragon, which was written, he wrote that for his kids. And so it has a bit of a different tone than a lot of the Stephen King writing. And I liked it. It was kind of, it was like a colored pencil drawing where someone didn't do the outlines, in that, like, it was just, there was substance there, but it was ultimately forgettable. And I just kind of remember it as like a fairly enjoyable color blur. It happened.
Apparently he himself, King, has written the script of the last episode and actually sort of written a different ending for the Stand on the show.
Very cool.
That apparently will go beyond the novel's ending. Like, it'll show some of what happened to those characters after the novel ended. So you'll get some new,
not a lot of characters to see what happens. All right.
We'll see. A new ending. We'll see. Lastly, before we get into our trailers, it was only a matter of time before these guys started getting a ton of stuff greenlit. Director of The Host, or just of Host, Rob Savage and Jed Shepard, just announced a new project and film about a haunted prison. The melding of a prison escape movie and a haunted house movie, in which a group of women who stage an unsuccessful breakout discover a secret room that unleashes a dark presence that marauds the halls at night. The film will have a claustrophobic quality akin to The Descent, and they're comparing it to The Conjuring in a prison, coming from the team who made Host, which we talked about on this show in one of our review segments. Connor and I liked it very much. Did you guys ever get around to watching Host?
Nope.
Yeah.
That sounds good.
I loved it. The bite-sized horror, I think, was just perfect. It was very, very effective in, you know, being the best product of the time that we're in, and taking something, you know, that we all were doing and making something actually kind of terrifying out of it. So it was the first thing that I actually sat down and watched on Shudder. So it was like a very strong first foray into checking out all that Shudder had to offer.
Yeah. I thought it was great. And seeing what those guys could make under such strange, constricting circumstances, they were gonna be getting phone calls after that thing was made. They also have something coming out with Sam Raimi producing, and this is not that. So they've already got two big productions, and apparently some sort of follow up to Host. That's not going to be a sequel, but it's going to be something else found footage related. So now that they're being let outside, they are going to be making a lot of things, it looks like. So
it's great just to hear.
Just excited for these guys, a couple young new filmmakers, really, really paving the way for themselves. You love to see it.
Right.
And also, yeah, I have not really seen a lot of haunted prison movies that I can recall.
That sounds like Gothica. Cool.
That was a jump scare.
Sorry. That was a Tron Legacy scare. She's from the future. Some light cycle up in this bitch.
it kind of reminds me of Gothica. A little bit. I mean, that's an insane asylum. It's a little different than a prison, I guess.
Not that different.
But no, they're very not that different. Like the, you know, being haunted and your cell kind of type thing, right?
Sure.
Is that what they're kind of describing?
The only good thing that came out of Gothica is Limp Bizkit's cover of Behind Blue Eyes.
Gothica was great.
Like I said, you know, it gave us a Limp Bizkit cover of Behind Blue Eyes, so I like it for that.
Hadn't thought of that in a while.
Oh, it's
I think dope. I got that album in like fifth grade, I think I recall.
I thought it was wonderful.
Back to the theater. Yeah, Limp Bizkit
Blue Eyes.
What kind of stasis device is Jessica plugged into that she just keeps like vampiring up from the future?
She's doing really scared VR under there.
Oh,
it's like she's really here, but she also is really here.
The VS of ours.
Very effective. So that's it for the news. We do got a couple trailers before we start talking about what we've been watching and reading, or at least getting really in depth into that. And boy, what a trailer to kick it off with.
Did you guys get to watch?
You didn't watch it?
Did you watch the trailer for Tremors? Let's bring it up. I don't think we're going to get copyright strike for
Tremor. You might.
Tremor Shriek.
You did not tell me about a Tremor trailer.
I don't think anybody is
hunting. Here, I'll show you the picture. I'll show you the picture of Tremor Shrieker Island.
What the hell?
Wait, yes.
It has the original guy in it, though.
So, yeah. Michael Gross, who plays Bert, has been in every single Tremors movie.
Yeah.
But do you know who that is? Do you know who that is? That is, of course, Napoleon Dynamite's own John Heater. With the
Nice.
Really?
John Heater's back, baby, and he's killing graboids.
I have a special relationship with the early Tremors films in that my family and I used to love watching Tremors 1 and 2.
Yeah.
And some lines from that movie still exist in our joke lexicon, right? Like the "I'm completely out of ammo." That's never happened to me before. Like, absolutely memorable line from Bert there. This is going to be a movie, though. I mean, you can say that about it. It's a film that's happening.
Yeah, it's
the graboids look cool. The graboids do look cool. Like, the idea of like sandworms is so overdone. So to make them like giganto island aquatic worms, yeah.
Yeah, putting a graboid in the water. Because last time, so I watched the Tremors film that existed before this. They put graboids in the snow graboids, and I believe they did some. They also, there was like a Tremors Western. It's gone all over the place. But yeah, Michael
call
Gross,
that Slither.
and they also had Jamie Kennedy show up as his illegitimate son, and he's not coming back for this. But they found John Heater, which is like somehow the same. I don't know why they're the same. Somehow it's the same, you know.
It's a lateral move.
Finding that somebody where you're like, oh yeah, I remember that person. From that comedy, and now that
you exist,
yeah. So you love to see it. Really happy for John Heater getting into the Graboids universe.
Yeah, glad to see he's not dead. Congrats.
This looks better than the last one for whatever that's worth. I'm not saying it's worth a lot.
It looks better than Ghost Shark. Like,
Yeah, I like you, Adam. For me, I think the first three I go as far on Tremors were really loved those as they were coming out. This one has the Shriekers coming back. If you remember those from Tremors 2, I guess they have not been in any other films. Mm-hmm. We'll see if the Ass Blasters from Tremors 3 make it.
we'll keep our fingers crossed.
Yeah, I think Tremors needs like a prestige soft relaunch where Kevin Bacon comes back, you know. That's what I'll say. Now we're talking, you know. Now we're paying respect.
Like, ignore all the other ones besides the first one, and then just do a
next one is gonna be Bert's gonna take a John Hammond move and open up Jurassic Park, but for graboids, and they're gonna start genetically splicing the graboids on purpose to try to make some crazy shit.
That's essentially what this is. It's about apparently a rich playboy who relocates graboids to an island so they can hunt
right.
them. And it goes poorly.
Wow. Shocking.
And you got to bring in old Bert.
The only guy that knows how to hunt the graboids.
Bring him. We'll see. Well, that's coming out. October 20th, so it's right around the corner, so you don't have to wait long. I'm happy to tell you.
That's the most dangerousest game.
I am...
The co-creator of Scooby-Doo, Where Are You, had died this week.
Oh, the co-creator of Scooby-Doo has passed away.
Hanna or Barbera?
This is...
Joe Ruby?
Joe Ruby. One of the co-creators of Scooby-Doo. Damn! That's pretty... Scooby-Doo's been around so long, I'm kind of just...
That's horror news.
First of all, I'm kind of surprised... Yeah, I'd say it's as related as Tremors.
Yeah. Do we do Where Are You from the original series, co-creator by Joe Ruby and Ken Spears, learned that Ruby had passed away at 87 years old.
87.
Man, at least he lived
so long. Scooby's been around so long. I'm actually surprised that the creator Scooby-Doo was still alive.
Right. How did you just die?
Yeah, I mean, that's
impressive.
Like my parents grew up on Scooby-Doo. You know what I mean? Like, and so did I. And so will the 10 generations after me, apparently.
1969 that it came out?
Damn.
Yeah, 1969.
What a legacy to leave.
Yeah.
Scooby. Don't get better than that.
Sorry, I just saw that and I thought.
No, that's worth mentioning. I would put that in my notes that I show started.
Sorry, guys.
Rest in peace, Ruby. Thanks.
R.I.P.
There she goes.
Back to Tron. She's got to res back in so she can save the mainframe like Bob from. I just forgot the name of the show.
That's okay. Here's another fun picture to put on the screen. This picture's really fun. Look at this.
Oh, God, this picture.
We got a trailer for a film called Come Play, which everything else in the trailer looks a lot better than this image. I just saw that picture and I was like, I gotta use that one. This trailer came out today. This is a movie I didn't know about. And it's already coming out as Halloween. From Focus. Looks like to be about some spooky internet monster. Sam, you just watched Countdown, so this is right in your wheelhouse, right?
No. I actually had more of like a Babadook ripoff vibe from it, with them sitting around reading this little internet story as some very, very, very poorly CGI monster runs around in the background.
Right.
But I was watching that trailer that you had sent me, and that exact picture was directly underneath the trailer, and I said, I swear, if this is going to pop up, like, this is going to, you know, I was on board until I saw that picture. Yeah, that one. Yeah. It's just not doing it for me. It's just really not doing it. You know, the thing with Countdown was that it really was, you didn't really see this death demon thing following you around. And it went places. It got a little kind of silly towards the end there, but like, at least it wasn't that.
I think the rest of it, again, I feel like I'm doing it a disservice by picking that image, but I just really wanted to put it right in your face like that.
That's the truth. I'm sure we'll see that.
The CG does look a little goofy, and maybe the monster design looks a little goofy, but I don't dislike this concept. It feels very like last couple of years, creepypasta, like internet horror story.
Creepypasta.
Yeah, like maybe a chip off the old Slender Man block, perhaps.
It could be better than Slender Man, though, right?
Maybe. I bet you'll be better than the Slender Man movie.
I mean, in terms of concepts, like, there's literally nothing new in this, is the one thing that, like, really jumped out at me. Like, the only thing that feels like a potential, like, wild card is that they say the kid has autism. Like, what are you gonna do with that? Like, are you just like, I feel like the only acceptable way to have something like that be like a main focus in a movie is if you're going to somehow highlight something about like the actual every like day-to-day life of people that have to live with different conditions or different ability, differently abled people from other people. Because if you're just going to use them as a vehicle, that seems a little exploitive.
Yeah. On that note, since we kind of talked about it at the beginning of the show, it really did kind of jump out at that they were so blatant to be like, oh, he has autism. If we're going to deal with nonverbal, if you want to address that, you know, people that live different lifestyles or have to, you know, cope in certain ways or have the situations like that, look at season 2 of The Umbrella Academy. Without getting into any sort of spoiler territory, I think they handled it, you know, beautifully. And as somebody who works with, you know, students of all varying levels of needs and things like that, it just almost seemed like a little bit of a cop-out or like a narrative tool instead of being authentic. So we'll see. It's an interesting concept, but the bar, I think, is kind of low on that one.
Yeah, and like I said, it is an interesting concept, but it's absolutely not a new one, right? I mean, we can go back to whenever you see the first Fatal Frame game came out, right? Of, like, monsters that you can only see on camera until...
Yeah.
Mysteriously, right. You start to be able to see them not on camera partway through the trailer, which maybe they'll get into that. Maybe they'll go a Ari Aster. What was this first one?
Hereditary.
Hereditary, where all of a sudden they've got all these rules established for what's happening, and then dude lights on fire when she throws book into the fireplace, and that breaks all the rules as established. And you're like, I was with you up until right there. What just happened? But,
yeah,
love.
Yeah, as far as I can see, I think the angle on having a nonverbal autistic, literally written and directed by Ari Aster, it seemed like having a nonverbal autistic protagonist is probably going to be leaning into the suspense of him not being able to enunciate and tell people what is happening to him and what he's experiencing.
Right
now. Is that potentially exploitative? Absolutely. It seems like he uses technology to communicate to people. So I guess that's gonna play into a technology monster for a kid who can only communicate using technology.
Sure.
And I like Jillian Jacobs, for whatever that's worth. She's in it as well.
I mean, to the flip side of the exploitation, maybe it's at the same time representation.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. I would have no problem. Like, I'm not saying I have a problem. Like, I absolutely agree that we need to have more representation in the media, but I'm curious to see how they handle it. I mean, I'm sure we'll get to it just like when we start talking about the show Lovecraft Country versus the book Lovecraft Country, representation versus exploitation.
Right.
Yeah. Isn't that like the job of people who create these movies with sensitive subjects like that to kind of put it out there in the right kind of way?
I think it's important to treat sensitive subjects as though they are sensitive subjects. Mm-hmm. And even if that just means taking a soft touch to it, right? Like, because basically, yeah, I think it's easy to view anyone who's using another's experience, whether it's a racial experience that they're trying to capture in the case of like Lovecraft Country, or if you have verbally abled people trying to paint a picture of someone who does need some sort of communication device. Basically they're a dog putting their mouth all over a thing is what they're doing. And it's very easy for them to accidentally hurt whatever they're doing. And so even if you're a golden retriever and you have the softest mouth in the world, you're still slobbering all over this thing that isn't yours. And so I think it's important to be as delicate as you can, and treat it as gently as you can with the best of intentions. But I think, ultimately it always ends up feeling gross.
Yeah. I think like Peanut Butter Falcon is a great example of how they went about it the right way. You know,
the involvement with that community and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
And we talk about representation, you know, having an actual actor who lives with Down syndrome rather than
very
just
true.
An actor right. to.
I think that's I think that's a very strong distinction that needs to be made as well. Yeah, absolutely.
Right. Yeah. I mean, we even saw it this summer with The Last of Us 2. And I know that there's sticking points all over the way the representation was done, but having a trans actor portray a trans character in a AAA title is massive.
Yeah, that's huge.
And, you know, whether it was done correctly or not, and, you know, whether it was soft or gentle, the actor even said that it was as authentic as possible. And I think that's the big thing, is that if you're going to strive for representation, it needs to be authentic.
Right,
accurate. Or else it comes off feeling gross and slimy.
Right, which is kind of what this trailer is communicating to my expectations about someone who has to live with nonverbal autism.
Right.
Yeah.
We'll see. Hopefully it can rise above that expectation and prove us wrong on that one. But hey, I love a horror movie calling their shot and coming out on Halloween.
Right.
They want to put it in that system. I want to be the guy. I want to be the guy. So we'll see. Last trailer, I know Matt was looking forward to talking about this, and I think Connor was as well. He was He was texting me about the trailer for the new Babysitter film, Killer Queen, coming to Netflix. They got a great shirtless Robbie and Mel. Look at that. What a dish.
Snack.
September 10th, that sequel's coming to Netflix. So it's coming out real fast. And I already hear Matt has made his presence known. So what do you guys think? The existence of a Babysitter sequel and this trailer.
I mean, I knew the sequel was happening. Last year, McGee came on Collider Live and talked about the sequel happening. And the Babysitter is just a guilty pleasure movie. It's so bad, it's good. That's how I feel about the Babysitter.
It knows what it is.
Yeah, it knows what it is. McGee knows what he's making. Like he knows he's not the big sci-fi epic guy he tried to be with Terminator, the action adventure guy he tried to be with the Charlie's Angels movies anymore. He's discovering what his shtick is and keeping with it. And with the Babysitter, I loved that trailer. I absolutely loved it because they're like, he's talking about everyone thinks I'm crazy after all the stuff that went down 2 years ago. No one believes me that this happened, this, that, and the other. And like, damn, I feel for this kid because like I watched this movie, and like all the bodies are gone. Even at the end, Samara Weaving's character's body, spoiler alert, well, the movie's like 2-3 years old now, she's gone after being crushed by a freaking car. She's no longer there. So you're like, what the fuck is going on? And then when you get to this trailer, everybody's back, and you find out that apparently they made a deal with the devil, and now they have like 3 hours to come back and take revenge. I was like, I'm for it. Let's go. And then for a movie we thought didn't have Samara Weaving in it, we got a tease that she might be. So I'm excited.
How are you feeling about some new McGee in your life, Connor?
I think this looks fun. Looks like more same fun that the first one was. So I'm excited.
I know what we've been talking about. Yeah, last time it came up was the lack of Samara Weaving, which was so good in the first one. But it looks like, maybe.
That she might be coming back.
Might be coming back, which if I were them, I wouldn't even bother concealing that. I'd be like, we got her back, baby. Mm-hmm. Having fun with Samara Weaving again. Come watch the movie.
I mean, she's big now.
Yeah, her star blew up after Ready or Not.
I wouldn't doubt that she somehow is in the new Scream movie. I feel like she will probably end up in there. She's worked with the Ready or Not directors before. I would be, revealing that she's in it from the get-go. You're already revealing that everybody else is coming back, so this reveals Samara leaving. I mean,
unless she's not really back, and that was a...
And that's what I was about to get to. But this friend that he's going on, like, this kind of date with the blonde...
No, because you can hear her voice saying hello, whatever his name is.
Yeah, but you could pull that audio from the first movie.
You wouldn't do that. She's back. She's 100% back.
I hope so. I think she's great. Everything I've seen so far, including that.
We get to see more of her this weekend, and I'm going to throw a plug in here for Real Talk because we're reviewing Bill and Ted's Face the Music, and she's in that. So.
That's right, yeah.
I will not be on that show because I'm waiting to watch it with my dad on Wednesday. That's kind of you showed me this when I was little, and I will not be watching or seeing anything about it until I get to watch it with him. So
makes sense.
Jessica's not seen any of the Bill and Ted, so that's a journey we got to go on together.
Yeah.
What? What?
I said you haven't seen Bill and Ted.
Oh, I'm watching one by one.
Unfortunately, the first two are no longer on Amazon Prime, which sucks.
So. Sam and Adam. The good old Sam Adam. What do you guys, do you have any thoughts on Babysitter?
Together we are Sam Adams.
I admittedly have not seen the original, the first one. Trailer for the second one looks like a lot of fun, though. And it'll definitely be something that I'll check out. I'll sit down and watch the first one relatively soon here. Especially if I want to catch it day and date. I think Netflix has done a pretty solid job of giving you a 1-2 punch and doing I'm Thinking of Ending Things 1 week and chasing that with The Babysitter the next week. So that'll be a good, it'll be a solid week for Netflix, I think. But if the first one is anything like the trailer for the sequel, I'm signed up. I'm in.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to Thinking of Ending Things too. Sam, you read that book, didn't you?
I devoured that in like a sitting. That was one of, I think, the best like psychological thriller horror books I've read in a very, very long time.
Wait, The Babysitter's based on a book?
No, I'm Thinking of Ending Things.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, which is hitting Netflix soon. And what I've seen from the embargo went up, so the reviews are starting to come out for it. And it definitely remains something that looks very much my shit, where it's like a lot of critics are going, I loved this, but a lot of people aren't going to love this. So I'm like,
yeah, I'm a little worried because that the trailer that they put out seems very tonally different from the book. But
oh, okay.
It's one of those things where I have been waiting for so long, and you know me and my love for Tony. You put Tony Collette in anything, and I'll sit down and check it out. So I'm hoping that it'll be somewhat faithful, but if the tone is off, I think they might lose me towards the end there.
We'll see. It'll definitely be a review film, I think, on this show. So hey, if you want to come back in, talk a little Charlie Kaufman on Netflix. We can do that. I guess now is as good of a time as any. We'll hopefully get Connor back on the screen pretty soon here, but now is perhaps as good a time as any to move on to our Lovecraft Country discussion. We had originally planned to start talking the pilot of this last week while we were joined by the almighty Alok Mishra and Naomi Grossman. Didn't quite get to it, and that's fine. The conversation was so great and belligerent, we just couldn't get to it. So we've got two episodes of Lovecraft Country to talk about. And I think we've got a great group here to talk about it. Obviously, last month, that the novel by Matt Ruff was our book club selection. So Connor, myself, and Adam all talk at length, along with my friend Matt, not this Matt, but a different Matt. We all talked at length about the novel. I believe Sam has also read the book, too.
Yep, so just Sam's read the book. The show.
And then we all watched these episodes. So I think we've got a pretty well-informed group here to talk about Lovecraft Country. So what do we think so far? Anybody can hop in first who's so inclined. What do we think so far about this show?
I'm the only person here who has not read the book, so I'm probably looking at it from a different eye compared to the four of you. And honestly, I love it. Comparatively, it's probably this summer's Watchmen. Like, HBO has no issue putting out fantastic content. And the lead actor's name is slipping right now. He was also in Netflix's The Five Bloods.
Jonathan Majors, right?
Yeah, Jonathan Majors. He's in
San Francisco, too.
See, I didn't see The Last Black Man in San Francisco, so I couldn't speak on that. But I did love him.
Really so good. Oh, did he freeze?
There he is.
We got him.
So just see his, just he has this presence to him. You can just read how he's feeling so well on his face, and even what's her Smollett? I know her brother's
Journey.
Thank you, Journey Smollett. The only thing I'd seen her before this is Birds of Prey in that movie. Like she was probably outside of Margot Robbie the best part of that movie, but I love the performance in this show. I love the weirdness because I mean, in that first episode with those creatures at the end, I was losing my shit. Like,
yeah, I want to start with episode one.
Yeah.
From reading the book, there was enough like adapted and pulled from the book where I'm like, okay, I know this, but they changed it up enough where it kept me safe. Especially that ending, where they're in the
cat. I would say it's very
different. So good.
Right from that first episode, in the book, Matt, there's pretty much no literal physical monsters anywhere in
there. There's absolutely none.
And we don't even get to the end of the first episode where literal shoggoths are chasing our protagonist through the woods. covered in eyeballs. There's that that never happens in the book. So right from that point, we're already on a different ride with this show.
Yeah, we see magic like a couple of times in the book, like in rituals and ceremonies and stuff. But there's no extra dimensional. There's a ghost, but like that's literally it in terms of the weird, the Lovecraftian weird.
Yeah, there's the suggestion of monsters, like the scene with the cops in the woods. That sort of happens in the book, but the protagonists don't see what took them. They're not being pursued by it.
They're just gone.
You never really come back to
it. Right.
Yeah, you never really find out what it was. So, I mean, I guess this is probably a symptom of this being an actual visual medium now. Probably not as interesting to have the suggestion of monsters somewhere. That's something you can do on the page a lot easier. That said, one of several critiques I had in the book was that shoe never really, never dropped. And we never did get around to figuring out what was going on with the monsters in the book, and I was let down by that.
I was about to comment that you guys kept talking about. I remember just from watching the episode, you guys kept talking about the lack of monsters. You keep implying that they're there, but you never really get any action. I'm like, and that's why that shocked me. I'm like, oh, shit. And I like the whole Dracula take that they had with the Shoguns. Like, I was just fucking beautiful.
Yeah. I'm kind of coming at it from the, I guess, the opposite point, from someone, who read the book, watched the show. I think both are fantastic, but I think I fear more of the unknown or the things that you don't see. So like those scenes in the woods in the book where, there was something abound, and having very little Lovecraft knowledge going into it. I thought it was actually rather effective for me, because I will forever be afraid of something that I can't see. Whereas, so then they, when they popped up in the woods, I'm like, oh, here they are. And it was definitely a different ride. Like you said, I did think that they would have had me just a smidge more if I maybe heard them and didn't see them, and we held that reveal for maybe a little bit longer, and kind of teased it just to kind of build that suspense before pulling back the curtain.
I mean, honestly, to me, that wasn't even the scariest part of the episode. To me, the scariest part of the episode was the ride to get out of the county. And then when you see them and there's that line of cars, just my heart broke. And I'm the only black guy here, but just hearing stories about that from relatives or similar stories and being pulled over and having situations where I'm just scared out of my mind, it hit me in a different way. So
that scene was even more intense than it was in the book.
I would agree. Yeah.
And I saw someone say, speaking of Watchmen, how after Watchmen came out, a lot of people were like, they researched the Tulsa Massacre, and I saw someone say it's going to have a similar effect with Sundown.
Sundown counties?
Yeah. I totally agree. I think HBO is great at putting a spotlight on these events in America that have been swept under the rug. And I applaud HBO for that. As a pilot episode, I think this was fantastic. Especially reading the book, I think there was enough similarities and enough differences where it was completely engaging. Where I'm like, completely like, I know exactly what's going to happen. Because they are changing it enough, and we'll get to that in the second episode. There's a lot of differences. So. Yeah, as a pilot, I loved it. 5 out of 5 for me.
Yeah,
and Adam, I am curious to hear your thoughts, because I know you were not as keen on the book when we talked about it last month. Had you watched both episodes or just the pilot?
I watched just the pilot.
Okay. What were your thoughts on that so far?
I think it's a good. I think it's a good base for a show for sure. I think I definitely like the show. From what I've seen, and obviously maybe this is news to Sam, but I think it's very clear to everyone else that I did not like the book at all. I thought it was very unskillfully handled. And you said, Sam, that you didn't read you're not super familiar with Lovecraft.
I am very, very low level with Lovecraft.
So, and again, this was speculation last month when we were talking about it. Other Matt and I both thought that, because he also has read Lovecraft before, that the Lovecraft Country title comes from sort of, it feels like Matt Ruff is trying to evoke the way that Lovecraft writes with the book. And so, but otherwise that has nothing to do with anything inside the contents of the book. Like Lovecraft doesn't come up at all. There's no cosmic horror. There's
right.
There's,
we got Other Matt in the chat. There he is.
Other Matt in the chat. Hi. Hey guy. But like, so the evocation of Lovecraft, I remember, is a thing that Matt, again, not speaking for him, he can speak for himself. He's watching. But Matt didn't like the evocation of Lovecraft, who does have a very storied and popular history as a racist. There's no reason to evoke him.
Right.
Unless you're going to evoke that racism, which was the point. But I didn't like it because Lovecraft is a shitty writer. He's just not good at writing. But that being said, he does do the unknown and madness and insanity and darkness. So these are all themes that he tackles. And so he does do more of that kind of stuff that you say that you like about, like, I'm much more afraid of a thing that I can't know or can't see or can't understand. Right. And I understand that fear. I get it. He's just not good at writing it. And so what Lovecraft has come, I think the show is much more meeting expectations. And that's what I like about it, because when we all hear Lovecraft now, what we come to expect is the kind of cosmic horror that is very corporeal. We all want Cthulhu. We want squiggly, wiggly, blobby, ugly eyeball shit. Right. We did get Cthulhu.
Kind of a Cthulhu bait and switch in that marketing. Because I remember like, how is Cthulhu in the show? And now it's just a dream.
Yeah. But that's like the kind of stuff, like when we hear Lovecraft, that's what's being evoked, is sort of the greater world that Lovecraft has been part and party to establishing. And so while I agree with you, I think it would have been cinematically much more effective to hold off on the Shoggoth reveal. I think it was very important to establish a break in tone in the pilot episode. I think it's going to be a tightrope between, like, where do we want to deviate from the book versus what do we want to hang on to the book to try to hit those themes and stuff. And I think it was an important sacrifice. And I do think it was a sacrifice to have the Shoggoth horror reveal that early. But I think it was important to establish we are still evoking the Lovecraft, but we're evoking him to meet your expectations. Because that was why the book was such a failure for me, is that I had expectations because of the setup, and they were all unmet. And so it was not necessarily a shitty book. It was just an ultimately disappointing experience. Fair. And so I think that the show has done, in the pilot episode alone, a great job of saying, like, communicating to someone who has read the book and had that experience of, we understand your expectations.
Right.
Here's the satisfaction. And it's like, horror-wise, yes, they should have held off for more suspense.
I don't think it would have worked if they didn't reveal it at the end, because in the second episode, we'll get into that now, I guess, in the second episode, they revealed that people in the town are actually kind of controlling them.
With the whistles
right.
that we hear.
Hard dog. So I think they had to reveal it then, because, you know, then it, like, you're just going to kind of casually throw in, like, hey, the townspeople controlling these monsters.
Right.
So I think they had to show them in this episode. But we were
it's a very TV pilot thing too, to have this big moment at the end to make you go, shoot, I gotta
draw you in.
For sure, yeah. For sure.
And I think we were talking about the differences. There's a lot of differences in this second episode. One, Caleb is now a daughter, female character.
No Caleb.
I was like, whoa.
Yeah.
Because I thought for sure it was that blonde dude. I was like, oh, there's Caleb.
Yeah,
it seems like the character doesn't even exist.
Yeah, it's
was he like the butler guy?
Sort of. He's not the butler, but he's. It seems like basically a new character, some sort of ally of the one that you see.
The blonde guy is the butler that we...
He is the butler.
Book, the one that kind of shows them around. That's that character.
Caleb, yeah, the one that was very...
instead they made Caleb's character into the daughter of Braithwaite. Is that what his name was?
Yeah.
So he has a daughter instead.
And so the chick that gets out of the Silver Daimler is like the Caleb character.
Yeah, that's Caleb. Yeah.
I think that makes more sense to have it as daughter because you know it's all about the sons of
Adam.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so it kind of makes more sense why they need
Atticus.
Yeah. Because he doesn't have a son. He has a daughter, so they need,
right.
Atticus. Should we talk about the ending of episode 2?
We're going to get there, especially if you want to mention how they needed to have a daughter. There's a lot of dialogue that's very heavy that points towards the themes of where Lovecraft Country is going as far as dealing with the race. And I think that it was handled very well as to kind of show why it was so important to have Atticus, besides the fact that he was a descendant and that he is a male. I think that these are the themes that they are going with. I think it was a very smart move, and it was perfectly well done to kind of stage the rest of the season.
Yeah, I will say I did not see that ending coming, though.
Yeah, that was a big step.
So, spoilers, they kill off his uncle in the second episode.
Yeah, George.
Really? George died?
Yeah.
Wow. So, Adam, the scene they have when they're all trying to escape after they get Montrose and Caleb, like, shoots them and then heals them, Letitia comes back, but George bleeds out and dies and doesn't come back.
Do you think they're going to revive him? So instead of the Montrose being like stasis, they're going to do some sort of like revivification kind of a thing later on?
I don't know. It seems like maybe. It felt like a very deliberate choice to take that character out for some reason.
Yeah, and like you saw in the, I don't know if any of you watched the preview for the next trailer, that plays a big part going forward, it looks like.
So. Yeah. Plays a big part in the, we'll get to the teaser for episode 3, but yeah.
They had another gender swap on their daughter as well.
That's right, yeah. George's daughter, who I can't remember the name of.
Is it D?
When he draws comic books. They call her D.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because his name was like, what was his name? It was a D name.
Was it Daniel or something?
I don't remember what it was.
It was a very old name.
They did change that as well. So,
but yeah, they have a daughter instead of a son.
Yeah.
Hippolyta and George's child. A lot of these small deliberate choices and changes throughout that I will be kind of interested to get to a point in the show where I just go, oh, that's why you changed it. You know, because and I'm glad that we did go ahead and read the book first, because I think that's going to inform the way I watch this quite a bit. And it is kind of a fun ride to see, because I like the book all right, but I'm not so married. I think that was it.
Horace is their son's name.
I'm not such a fan of or so married to the book that I'm like, oh man, don't change it. Don't you dare change the scripture of Lovecraft Country.
Right.
Yeah. There's the beginnings of a compelling story and a good idea from that book. So I'm hoping they can figure out what it was, and through the show and whatever changes they're making to it, really, really strengthen what it was lacking from the book. I know something we talked about a lot was we were perhaps kind of uncomfortable with the idea of a white author having written the book, even though as far as my perception goes, I can say it seems like it was pretty well researched. I'm sure, but again, I'm speaking from the perspective of a white dude. I imagine that I want to say and hope that he respected the material enough to try to respect it. But all the same, it does feel, I don't know, it feels a little exploitative to have, a white author get that story published. And the show, we have this coming from Misha Green as the showrunner. Obviously, we've got Jordan Peele on as a producer. I think this
J.J. Abrams.
Yes. Great person of color, J.J. Abrams.
What did you say? So, hey, he's an honorary brother.
I think they've got a good team on it that I think having actual perspective coming from an actual black person, black writers, I think that will strengthen the story a lot more than the book as well. And it looks like we're going to the Letitia stuff next. You mentioned the teaser. It looks like we're going to the haunted house stuff next.
It looks scary.
Yeah, you know what? And so you mentioned it's scary. That's what this has that the book doesn't, is the characters are scared out of their minds all the time.
Right.
Rightfully so.
Right, yeah.
The book just kind of had them just skipping through the madness.
Guess I'll go into another planet.
Yeah, there's magic. Well, all right, I'll deal with that. Oh, there's monsters.
I'm going to tell this haunted house I'm in charge now.
Hey, Ghost, do you want to play chess?
This literally has them running through the woods, shrieking, drenched in blood as their entire perception of the world is dismantled in one night. And I was like, there we go.
Right.
The
one thing about that scene, the end of the pilot, why didn't they give Letitia the flashlight? Anybody? She's running through the woods, why didn't
they? Because otherwise they wouldn't have any light.
The deputy had a flashlight on his shotgun.
Oh, yeah, he did.
But he had a flashlight on his shotgun, and then they had the handheld one that they took from that George took from the cop's hand.
If you look at it,
but they
needed that flashlight once the sheriff turned, because the sheriff ate his deputy right away, so they needed that flashlight.
Yeah, but I just mean for realism's sake, I'd be like, okay, I'll go, and then someone has to talk me out of going. I'm gonna be like, okay, well, I'm gonna make sure you're as prepared as you can be to not die then, because I don't care if I die, but if you're going to go and you're going to die, I'm going to feel real bad. So take the flashlight.
They're running. So, I mean, if you're running, you don't really have the opportunity to just stop in your tracks and make sure you're aiming it at the thing right away. So.
Well, right. But if you have a flashlight and it doesn't like light and you're flailing a light around, I would think that maybe it would help deter them. Or, let's prepare for the worst and you start getting eaten. Maybe shining a flashlight would make the thing eating you stop eating you.
They did try to give her the flashlight, but she said, no, you guys keep it. Because that.
I'm actually going to go straight down.
And I don't remember that. I just remember, I'll go. Yeah, you were a track star.
Not up that she ran track, and she's like, I can get to the car really fast
because I'm
track. You guys keep the flashlight.
Yeah, I don't know. I didn't like. That was the one part that was like, look, my disbelief can only go so far, and there's shoggoths outside already. So,
I didn't
bitch take the flashlight
because the shotgun's right next to a weird monster thing turning, and
I did like that.
Keep it to keep that away. I can run. I ran track. I can get to the car.
I'm watching the scene right now.
You can run track with a goddamn flashlight. Put it in your hand.
Helper. I mean, running forward.
But if something jumps down in front of you while you're running, I mean, real life, not movie life. It would be pitch black in there. You wouldn't be able to know where you're running. Have you ever run through the woods at night? Probably not.
Where I don't get, I respect your opinion, but that's where it lost you was the flashlight?
Yes. Yes.
You got bit by a monster.
Right.
And is turning into said monster.
Right.
A flashlight is what lost you.
Well, no, the fact that she wouldn't be able to see at all with running through the woods in pitch black is what lost me. Yes. Like I said,
running in the pitch black lost.
I'm very specific when it comes to if you want to play science games, if you want to play science games, you better bring your science receipts. And if you want to play magic games, you don't need receipts because it's goddamn magic. But when it comes to like the science of a monster, I don't know fucking anything about the science of a monster. That's why monsters are great. But when it comes to the human eye, I know all about the rods and cones and that shit. Like, you can't see stuff without light. We're not cat people. Maybe she's cat people. Maybe it'll come up later that she can see in the dark. I get
it. That's a big reveal at the end of season one. She's cat actually people. A cat person.
She's cat people.
I'm just saying, I don't get that kind of logic when it comes to, you know, horror and fantasy. And
it's got, like, if there are people talking when about you, Marvel, when you establish rules that have to make sense.
This is where the Marvel movie lost me. And it's like, we're talking about superheroes.
Right.
In this case, we're talking about a fantasy horror series.
Correct. It's set in a contemporary real world with real rules. And it's, if you're introducing new elements, they don't need to follow those rules. But when you're establishing elements that are already existing within the system, they need to follow the rules. Otherwise, you start to violate the suspension of disbelief. And that's just basic writing 101.
Can I butt in real quick? Adam, you were correct. They did not. So here's how the scene goes. He was about to just run out himself, and they told
him.
And the sheriff stopped him. He wasn't even going to take the flashlight. So she's like, "I'll go. Let's go." I ran track. He gives her the pep talk, and she goes, "No,
right."
It was not offered. None of
it. And at that point, it was dark out. Was it not?
Yes, it was.
And so it would be like legit. You can't see shit. And so, but like that's just basic attention to detail is what gets me, where it's like you've got all this big stuff going on. It's like practicing your detailing and your rendering on a piece of art when you don't understand perspective yet. Like, whoa, you need to understand the basic fundamentals. Like, where'd you go? But yeah, so it's not like I like bailed on the entire show or anything. It was just for me that was a point where I was like, you did a weird one there. It's just like when Scarlet, I mean, you could talk about the Marvel Universe too, because like in the Marvel Universe, they established this Scarlet Witch as like this Omega level mutant, and then she can't beat not Power Stone Thanos. It's like, you should, like, you could literally clap. You could literally basically
wreck his shit in the next movie.
Yeah. Like, you could literally fart him out of existence. Like, what are you dicking around for, Witch? Just vaporize.
I want to say
that stuff does not bother me, because I've already suspended so much belief to actually put myself in this like world. Like, these are superheroes. Like, I don't care about small stuff like that. Like,
you can't establish boundaries and then break the boundaries. A
grimace like man is teleporting through time. Like, I don't give a shit about like small lapses in logic like that.
That's not a small lapse.
Adam, in Connor's defense, you have to remember
a series where there are demon monsters in all kinds of shit. Like a not being able to see in the dark, that doesn't faze me. I mean, it's not going to take me out of the whole entire episode, or it's not going to lose me whatsoever. It's not even going to faze me, because I'm already in it. There's enough going on where I'm like, well, this isn't the real world. If this was a regular, like, I'm running from a serial killer type thing, then I'd be like, well, why didn't you take the fucking flashlight? But we're not talking about
But you still have those same rules, though, in applying to that situation.
Adam, in regards to rules, and something that you can say to in Connor's favor is the fact that she was in the middle of, her attention was ripping that stone from Vision's head while she's trying to fight off Thanos. So she didn't have her full concentration on him. So it's not really suspending your belief at that point.
Sure. I mean, I just like Scarlet Witch, and also it's just a difference between MCU and the actual established like comic canon, where Scarlet Witch is like Omega level. She can create and end universes, right? So she could just do that. Like, what is one purple man?
Why is Taylor on Quibi?
We had some sort of internet outage here, so I've gone mobile. No. Did we solve the flashlight conundrum?
No.
We're gonna move on to the teaser. Well, we already talked about the teaser. Just move on to the book.
Yeah. Well, there was something I wanted to say, and I forgot what it was. I forgot what it was. Other than I'm enjoying the show so far.
Yeah, it's a good show, it looks like.
I think the changes that they made from the source material will hopefully inform a better experience in this format. And I'm definitely coming back for episode 3. Our plan is to do like weekly recaps. This was at 2 episodes, so it was a little more than will be normal. But our idea is to do weekly recaps. So as long as it's good, keep us coming back. We'll keep talking about Lovecraft Country. Now I no longer have keys to the city here, so Matt, I'm gonna need you to throw up the graphic real fast.
Oh shit! Yeah, no problem. I was about to jump out, so I'll just get behind the scenes.
That's all I need to do. Just throw it up real fast. It's time and change our banner if you don't mind.
Yes, no problem. Just there we go.
Yes, it is time for us to get into our August selection for our book club. This month we read and we'll be discussing Survivor Song by Paul Tremblay. A very, I guess you would say, either ill-timed or wonderfully timed horror novel about a rabies pandemic ravaging the globe, and follows Ramola, I think is how you would say her. That's how I was reading her.
Ramola.
Ramola.
And I listened to the audiobook. They say Ramola in that.
Ramola. Okay. A doctor who is escorting her pregnant friend Natalie through this rabies ravaged Boston, or at least close to it. As spoilers, as we have down there, Natalie's been bitten, has contracted rabies, and basically
super rabies.
They're operating on the assumption that she's doomed and they need to get that baby out of there as soon as possible, and basically trying to find a safe way to do that. All told in real time, all told within the time span of less than a day.
Right, it's like 4 hours.
Really. Yeah. So it is a quick, for me, it was a quick read. I don't know how you guys approached it or felt about it, but that's sort of the setup to what Survivor Song is about. And then again, I'll let anybody kind of jump in and get the ball rolling here. But what did you guys think of Survivor Song?
I will say at first, it was not a quick read. I read like the first like 100 pages, and that took me a while to read because I was just like surprised, like get to the spookies, get to the zombies, and then I was just like, oh yeah, I'm gonna just try to get through it. And once I get about halfway, I couldn't put it down. So at the halfway mark and on, like it was a quick read. I couldn't put it down. Strong point, I think, was the whole entire story of those two teenagers after that little chunk that is focused solely on them. I thought
Josh and Louise.
So fucking good.
Yeah.
So sad. It's just about these two friends that one of them, spoilers, gets bitten and is pretty much doomed. So they just go on by themselves, and the other friend pretty much sacrifices himself and decides to just go out with his best bud. So kind of like we all got that friend, you know. But I thought it was a beautiful chunk of the story.
Yeah.
Overall, I loved it. I thought it was really good. Like I said, like at that halfway mark, it was just, it just kept coming. So I would say like the first 100 or so pages was kind of a trudge for me, but after that, it was really helpful.
Now, kind of a side tangent, but Sam, I know you are a Paul Tremblay fan very much like I am. Have you read Disappearance at Devil's Rock?
I have not. I think that's maybe one of the only two of his that I haven't read.
Yeah, go ahead, sorry.
Go ahead.
I only bring it up because Josh and Louis are actually characters from that book.
Oh.
Which I didn't realize at first while reading it. And then went, oh man, we got kind of a Tremblay verse going on here. And then I got upset because they both died. There they go.
Rip.
So sad to learn of, so but I will say that section of their demise was not what I expect or am used to seeing out of a story like this. It was
seeing somebody kind of go out on their own terms and within a zombie pandemic type story, deliberately infecting themselves out of just submission and defeat and desperation was that was a really sad little chapter to read.
Yeah, I even texted you, like, did you get to that part yet? Because I was going to be like, Jesus Christ. I had to put it down after that because I was just, like, heartbroken.
Yeah, that was tough. And even more so when I realized, oh, these are characters that I really enjoyed in a different novel already. but kind of fascinating to learn that those took place in the same world. Now, obviously, we got a little ahead in the plot here. but I agree, from kind of the point where they enter the novel is when it really picks up speed and doesn't slow down. And that's when it's probably its most dire, because about then is when Natalie's displaying hydrophobia. And that's when we understand, like, Natalie's not going to make it to the end of this. So it's literally just a chase to try to get that baby out of her safely before it's too late. So that's when it gets, I agree. For me, that's when it got really tense. But maybe we should kind of dial it back, you know, and look at the whole book. This is clearly inspired by zombie fiction and tropes, though I'm sure a zombie purist would say it's not a zombie story because it's not the reanimated dead, but it is that they do function very similarly to zombies, but playing by the rules of what we know about the actual rabies virus, and just all they really had done, or he had done, the author, was kind of accelerated the infection rate, or the way that it spreads in your body, which is not through your blood, but through your nervous system.
And added kind of a weird coughing component. That's not a rabies thing.
Yes. And also makes you spout certain weird apocalyptic prose.
That's actually not too dissimilar from actual rabies. Weird. I've studied rabies. But yeah, weird.
Interesting.
My history degree is in... Well, my history degree is in historical epidemiology, actually. So studied diseases based on primary sources and things like that in history. And rabies is a thing that I actually did a focus paper on when I was younger. So, but rabies does actually make you hallucinate. That's actually true. Like, you do have weird hallucinations. You have weird waking dreams. And they tend to be noted, like, notably bizarre. Like, you do say and think and see weird-ass shit, by all accounts, when you do have rabies. That's... like when it starts setting in, that's true. But like coughing, like there's no, like the barking cough is a thing that comes up throughout as like sort of the signal, right, of the harbinger, the scary. That's the spooky in the show, is like, who's coughing? What's coughing? Where's the coughing coming from? But that was the weird part, it was weird because it is otherwise very much like a pretty true to form rabies. But then the coughing came up, and I'm like, it's kind of a weird addition. Who's crinkling? What is that noise?
Hey, real quick, I just want to bring it up real quick. Is the audio going nuts for everybody else or just me?
I hear like a weird crinkly.
Is someone a crinkle?
Is it a crinkle or a creeping?
Here too. Shoot, it must be coming from me doing it on the phone. There it is, right?
Yeah.
Now. You hear right now?
Yeah.
So it's not just on
the
I'll put some headphones in this thing, but I got this damn iPhone, man. I can't put any of these headphones in here. I don't hear right now. Nobody is right.
Right? Oh.
Nobody hears right now. Oh no. Going off the rails. All right. How's it sound now?
It's like comes through when it comes through, like when you speak.
I'm gonna drop out for a second. Yeah, you guys
did that. That fixed it, right?
Yeah.
Clearly, it's his fault.
Yeah. So, I mean, what did you guys think of?
I really enjoyed it. It was one of those things where I didn't realize that he had a book coming out until like a week before it came out. And yeah, I mean, it was a great surprise. And then I started reading what it was about and I was like, oh, this is very opportune timing for him, I guess. And so I picked it up and I blew through it in, I think, 2 days. Like the like you said, the first about 100, 150 pages were not hard to get through. I found it a little bit easier than maybe a couple of his other books where I was like really into the story right away. But I really, I guess two parts. One, I think I knew from the drop where we were going as far as the end game. Like as soon as she got bit, I was like, oh, this is how this is going to end. So whatever happens in between here, like, is going to be really intense and really heartbreaking. And I think I really liked it because it was just something different from him, you know, between Growing Things and The Cabin at the End of the World and A Head Full of Ghosts. Like, they were all in that same kind of vein, whereas this is something completely separate. And so I do really like to see him branch out. Him and Grady Hendrix are two of my favorite authors, and Grady has done up until this year like almost exclusive paranormal and supernatural horror. And so for him to come out with a vampire book and like just this fun 90s vampire slaying book, it's just nice to see these authors kind of step out of their comfort zone and flex their muscles. And so I really think that was a solid effort from Tremblay. While we were getting started, I was trying to find it. There was a tweet that somebody had sent to him about Ohio distributing the rabies vaccine, like airdropping it through some part of Ohio. And I was like, oh great, here we go. This is peak 2020 now. Like, we're just gonna have super rabies and that's how this is gonna end. Like, awesome. But I think it was maybe one of his best so far. Adam, what about you?
I didn't like it.
Should we be surprised by that?
I don't know. I mean, I read a lot of books.
Give us your spiciest take on it.
I don't, it's not fair to be spicy, because I'm sure he put a lot of work into it. I'm sure he put a lot of research into it, and I'm sure for some audiences it's very appropriate. I just wasn't sure what to expect. I didn't expect it to read as young adult as it did. I mean, it seems like, aside from saying a few potty words, like, it should be a book that's in a young adult section, which is fine if that's what you want. That's just not what I wanted out of it. But like a lot of the tropes that were evoked felt almost like Buffy the Vampire Slayer-esque, in that he was trying to make it like a timepiece, almost like a nostalgia 2000s kind of a thing, with let's evoke Fortnite, let's talk about Twitter, let's talk about, you know, making vines, you know, all this kind of stuff. That was just like, I get it, you're hip, great. Just the way that they spoke, like, I don't know anything about the author. So I'll absolutely disclaimer that I don't know anything about Paul Tremblay. Like, I'm assuming he's an American.
An app teacher.
Yeah. There was just so much like forced Britishisms in there. Like, it just felt like a thing that a lot of my like Anglophile friends and like European people that travel a lot, that really want people to know that they travel a lot, right? Like, oh yeah, let's put in bangers and mash, you know, and they're noshing and all this kind of stuff. And it was like, just like someone who's lived here for that long, like, would have a few like holdovers for sure. But like, it just felt weird how he would evoke the British slang from Ramola. It just didn't feel very believable, almost, I guess, in where it was. And then the forced usage of gnats and rams, like, yeah, okay. It's funny because it felt like a criticism that Josh and Luis made in the Josh and Luis section, right? I think it was Luis that said he doesn't like the usage of like walkers and shamblers because it feels so writer's table, right? Like no one actually talks like that. Like a lot of my criticisms of the actual writing of the book is exactly that. Like I understand, like, someone may have said that, like, we'll all have nicknames for people and all that kind of stuff. But a lot of the things that came across, whether it was the Britishisms or like the usage of each other's names and stuff like that, it felt very writer's table-y. It felt very forced. It didn't feel very believable. Going back to like the text messaging and like the technophile scenes where he just felt like he really needed to include that like contemporaneous feeling of like, let's have a group chat going on. You know, like, I get it. That's believable and stuff. Sure. We all have those. But it just felt out of place in the book to me. Like, it just mechanically didn't feel very well put together, I would say. There are good parts in it. I did like the Josh and Louise. I did like that part as well. It definitely did pick up at that halfway point. I absolutely agree with you, Connor, on that. In that I was really like, what did I get into? Like, when I first started it. Also, I wasn't crazy about the narrator. Erin Bennett was the narrator of the audiobook. And she didn't win me over at any point throughout her narration at all.
Unfortunate.
Yeah. So that could play a role in how I received it as well. She just sounded bored most of the time. So I was just kind of,
yeah. It doesn't look like Taylor's going to make it back.
Unfortunate. Yeah. So I could have enjoyed it more, I think. But unfortunately I just wasn't on board with it.
Yeah. So second book in the book club in a row where Dan, another divisive book club. I think do you guys have any other thoughts on the book to share?
I mean, just besides the fact that it was obviously very timely, and it did seem like he put a good amount of work into it, where, you know, Adam, you had said besides the cough, it seems pretty spot on. That I think, as far as, you know, not knowing a whole lot about rabies, I was suddenly kind of terrified of rabies for a while. And it just was a very timely, and I mean, who would have thought that we'd be sitting here in the book came out in July, that we'd be sitting here in the middle of a pandemic talking about something like that. So it's just, you know, one of those memorable moments, I'd say.
Yeah, definitely. I think it was a very appropriate book to read during our book club. But I think that's gonna wrap it up.
Solid.
I think it was a solid book in Lovecraft Country, two solid episodes. So stay tuned. Next week we'll be talking about episode 3 of Lovecraft Country. We'll reveal our book club book.
Yeah. We've got Matt sneaking on with
I just cut off the phone with Taylor. That's why I had to clear some shit up with him. I heard Connor talking about he's closing out, so he told me to make sure I plug next week's special guest, Dr. Scott Brocious, who is a local Cleveland independent filmmaker. He's coming on to talk about his film Vile, that's actually going to be premiering next Saturday in Euclid. It's an outside, socially distanced open screening. Scott's a really cool guy. One of the best independent film talents in Cleveland, and I'm excited that we're able to get him on Reely Scared personally. But yeah, we'll have more about that for next week. Of course, Real Talk this week, like Connor just said, next week you're revealing your new book. So anything I'm missing?
No, I think that's it.
There is something I'm missing. Tomorrow, let me fix my camera. Tomorrow we got our new episode of the Really Trivia Showdown, where we have the Semen Demon versus the Fury, which I'm excited for everyone to see that match. I really am. So I'm really excited about that. It's going to be a great match. And yeah, Semen Demon, it's Connor, you know anything that the Semen Demon's got planned?
Hijinks and gross.
fair enough. All right, well, this is your show, so I'll let you close it out. So
thank you guys for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Hope to have you guys on again.
Sure.
Month for book club. I'm not sure what we're reading. I think Taylor had picked it out, but I'm sure he'll share that with us eventually. If you guys want to stop in, talk about Lovecraft Country episode 3. We're doing a discussion on that as well. So thank you guys for stopping by the show.
Sure thing. Thanks again.
Later.
Have a good one.